Act 1 of The Lords of Ellingham by Henry Spicer. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. The extraordinary event known as Rayleigh's Conspiracy is too fully chronicled in the page of history to need more than a very brief recapitulation. It was a plot originating, as it would appear, with the Earl of Northumberland, Lord Cobham, and Sir Walter Raleigh, having for its object the subversion of the existing government, obtaining large supplies of money from foreign states, and, as was generally believed, the exaltation of the Lady Arabella Stuart, cousin german to the King, James I, and in the same propinquity to the throne. A subordinate plot was formed by Sir Griffin Markham, George Brooke, brother to Lord Cobham, and others, urged on by Watson, a Catholic missionary, which, though designed to cooperate with the former, was more immediately directed against the King's person. The views of the conspirators were encouraged by Count of Remberg, ambassador from the Archduke of Austria, who for this purpose employed a certain adventurer named Matthew La Lorenz, or Lorenzi, by whom the conspiracy was eventually betrayed. Characters: Sir Gerald Latimer,
read by Larry Wilson.
Dudley, his son.
Act 1 through 4,
read by Mike Manilakis.
Act 5,
read by Beeswaxcat.
Lorenzi, an adventurer, now a spy, formerly a protege of Sir Gerald.
Read by Kerry Adams, your book voice.
Walter Vivian, a ruined prodigal.
Read by Rick Cordray.
Sir Griffin Markham, conspirator with Dudley Latimer in the attempt in favor of the Lady Arabella Stuart.
Read by Adrian Stevens.
Rook, conspirator with Dudley Latimer.
Read by Greg Giordano.
Farningham, conspirator with Dudley Latimer.
Read by Algie Pug.
Peyton, conspirator with Dudley Latimer.
Read by Jim Hedrick.
Watson, a priest, conspirator with Dudley Latimer in the attempt in favor of the Lady Arabella Stuart.
Read by Chuck Williamson.
Mago, a king's officer.
Read by Kevin S.
Gargantua, a deformed dwarf, paid to Edith.
Read by Alan Mapstone.
Hugh Kenzel, a jailer and headsman.
Read by Andrew Gauntz.
Grossfeld, servant to Lorenzi.
Read by Redrun.
Wilhelm, servant to Lorenzi.
Read by Faraz Niaka.
Countryman, read by Alan Mapstone.
Officer, read by Jim Locke. Huntsman, read by Jim Locke.
Edith, an orphan, ward of Sir Gerald, married to his son.
Read by Matea Bracic.
Ethelind, her attendant.
Read by Greg Giordano.
Marion, daughter of Kensel.
Read by Wendy Katzhiller.
Marjorie, a housekeeper.
Read by Krista Zaleski.
An old gypsy.
Read by Kelly Taylor.
Girl, read by Lynette Calkins.
Maud, read by Kelly Taylor.
Stage directions, read by Todd. Scene in Hampshire. Time, 1603. The Lords of Ellingham, Act 1. Scene 1. An apartment in the manor house of Ellingham. Sir Gerald Latimer is discovered asleep on a couch, Edith watching by him. Sir Gerald, waking.
Yes, it is gone. The glorious dream is gone. The world shuts around me like the closing bars of some strong prison. I have yet to die. Restrain a while thy wings, impatient soul. Thy flight will be the fairer. Ah, this hand, so soft and cold. My Edith, it is thine. Didst note of my slumber, Edith?
Father, yes, how calm it seemed. How like, save for its stern and rigid majesty, to that great sleep which ends above. Some heavenly hand, I know, must guide the wandering fancy that can tend to rest so calm as thine. Dear father, so I'll call thee still, who hast so freely given the only parent love this heart hath known, thou hast found healing in the world of dreams, a skilful leech's slumber.
Let me rise. Draw back these heavy curtains. Thanks, my child. So would I have it. Ah, 'tis better far. Not in the silent chamber's dusky gloom, where pale attendants and the tiptoe tread of slippered nurse and leech give death a mien unjustly hideous. But where things of life may meet and mingle with his grateful prayer, bright heavens above him, and around a world all fresh and beauteous from its maker's hand, would the old soldier give his soul to God.
There is a balm in nature's healing breath, surpasses human skill, a sweet, fond nurse that with a kiss doth cure. Even while I gaze upon thy face, dear father, I could think that eye grows brighter and this hand more firm. Oh, you will live to bless your children long with that beloved smile.
No, dearest, no. In the night watch midst fairest dreams that e'er crown mortal fancy, death has spoke with me, and I have braced my spirit's armor on to meet my king in heaven. Tell me, love, canst recollect thy mother? Why ask? I know thou canst not. 20 years have flown since she, this bosom's earliest love, became a glittering angel in the courts of God. She should have been mine own. 'Tis vain to raise the ashes of this buried grief again. Long have we waited for our bridal day. 'Tis come at length.
Alas, what mean you?
Tell me, is not this day the 2nd of the month?
It is.
This day she died, so young, so fair, as if a creature molded from the dust to gather store of human hearts, then die, to make the spectre men are taught to fear, a bright and holy thing. How like thou art, how very like pale cheek and speaking eye, sad sweet smile. Nay, move not, now heaven bless thee.
Oh, is there not another should partake this treasured blessing?
'Tis of my poor boy that I would speak to thee. Nay, let him come. If that indeed a dying parent's love may once outweigh the dearer fellowship of strange companions.
Dear sir, wrong him not. He is within. A breath shall summon him and prove his true affection. Dudley, come!
Enter Dudley Latimer.
Our father calls thee.
Latimer, kneeling by the couch.
Edith, I'll no more resign my privilege with thee to share these loving vigils.
Dost thou love me, boy? I will not doubt, but prove. To what I ask, reply without reserve.
On all things, sir.
Aside.
Save one. Pray heaven he do not touch on that.
A dark suspicion haunts me. Thou shalt drive the phantom hence. 'Tis rumored. Rumored, boy. Treason hath singled out this quiet vale for its unholy spells, that its false mien hath from their duty and allegiance lured some certain of our friends. Peyton is one, Sir Edward Parham, the young Farningham, George Brooke, and Griffin Markham. Can it be, nay, blush not, boy, I said 'twas rumor, that amid the number of this traitorous band, thy name should e'er be reckoned?
Father, I?
Sir Gerald, raising himself.
Oh, boy, wouldst pause and palter with my word, till threatening death thy pale auxiliar glides between us? Mark me, if thou dost desire the last brief hours of our communion here should pass in peace and love, reply to me as a man to man should answer.
Latimer, still hesitating.
Pardon me, I know not if...
Sir Gerald bends over and catches a paper from Latimer's bosom.
Look, sir, 'tis Watson's hand. He writes to thee. On what? What seeks the knave? What is the popish villain to my son? Great heaven, I see it all. Oh, Dudley, Dudley, if such could do thine honor force the way, how weak its guard! Take thy credentials, sir. They soil a soldier's hand, ungrateful boy. Disloyal subject bringing such foul stain on my untarnished name. Take the base scroll, and with it my...
Edith, throwing herself at his feet.
Oh, father, hear me speak. Let not the anger due to hoary rogues and practiced traitors fall with such dread weight on the young spirit they have tampered with. His heart is true and noble. He ne'er failed to thee in pious duty, nor to me in love most boundless. Speak him kindly, sir. Where's guilt such looks as these?
Enough, dear girl. Plead not, as for a criminal that hath no cloak for deeds at error. Be mine the name of that weak puppet who, on England's throne, hemmed in by faults and greedy flatterers, with acts of daily rigor from his rule, some loyal heart divorces. 'Twas for this, and in defense of that most injured lady, whose crime is that her veins run royal blood, no more, I joined with those whose manhood urged some sudden measure to redress the wrong, and though ne'er heart warm in a cause I knew my father would disown, I felt it just, and, so persuaded, would have furthered it.
An error, boy. No cunning sophistry can give fair color to the plea that arms a subject's hand against an anointed head. Poor though his policy and weak his rule, James Stuart is our king. Shall these old veins have given their juice and strength of youth for him whose right thou wouldst invade? My time is brief for such a theme. Yet a few fleeting hours, and blood and treason, peace and kingly rule, shall be alike to me. But for the sake of this poor innocent, I charge thee, boy, recall the fatal pledge thou mayest have given. Save both thyself and her. Dost promise me? I know thou wilt.
My dearest father!
Here, give me thy hand, my boy. I'd look once more upon yon glorious light, whose near decline is to these eyes eternal. Listen both to what I say. When some months past, my Dudley, I gave you, at God's altar, this fair prize, that act which love and wisdom both did urge scarce, had its source in justice. She, in years too tender to reject, the ill-judged bond was pledged to Laurency.
To Laurency, my father?
Aye, to Laurency was pledged. That youth whose wild demeanor made these halls no fitting home for him. Thy father, Edith, upon his deathbed, took thine infant hand and pledged thee, with thy store of untried love, thy noble name, broad lands, and coffered gold, to yon unthankful boy. He died and left his orphan to my care. I loved thee, child, first for thine angel mother's sake, but soon no less thine own. Could I stand passive by and mark thy young and warm affections launched upon such troubled waters? No, I kept the secret here, and when I saw love's flower spring silently twixt Dudley's heart and thine, strove not to check its growth. Speak, did I wrong? Couldst give more perfect love to him who claims, but at another's will?
Love knows no bond, no power, save its own mighty impulse to select its throne. Mine did so. It is here.
Embraces Latimer.
Then the last cloud that dimmed my spirit's peace is rolled away. The mind of Laurency is proud and vengeful. Yet I trust that time hath given him to a fitter bride, and thus no thought of rankling jealousy or hate shall cloud the sunshine of my children's peace. Now I would sleep again, but first kneel down together to my side. Weep not, my child. We are all friends, all happy friends again.
The scene closes. Scene 2. The interior of a hovel on the moor. An old gypsy cowers over the embers. A girl attends her. Girl, approaching timidly.
Art better, mother?
I am cold, cold, cold. Ague without, and a burning fire within. That what with shivering joints and seething brain, 'tis a marvel life doth. Hark! Set ope the door. One comes across the wold.
Girl, listening at the door.
I hear no step.
I feel it. A short, heavy step. A step neither of man nor child. He comes. How now?
Enter Gargantua in a rich habit.
My spiteful imp. my comely infidel, my tricksy child of darkness, art thou come at last?
Less malice in thy greeting, mother, else wert thou at the final gasp, I'll ne'er obey thy summons more. Farewell.
Come back? What, art thou not my child?
Aye, so you tell me. And should I waver in that fond belief, the brook that mirrors and the waning moon aping the curve of this accursed form might whisper whence it came.
Thou liest, imp. Hag as I am, I once was beautiful. Thou from thy cradle but a wise and sprite to scare big women in their thralls and thus increase a monstrous breed. Wouldst twit me with thy hunchback?
Gargantua, stamping furiously.
Woman, witch, hast aught to tell?
Art surly with me, sirrah. Have a charm shall make thee like the wild cat, spit and squeal. There, sit ye down. I met one in the wood whom thou must know of, him who was betrothed to Lady Edith.
Gargantua, starting.
Laurency?
Hark, boy. Once and again I've whispered in thine ear, when hath thou my warning failed? Hither he comes, with villainous intent. I've read his thought. A rogue's face is a study pleases me. He had a comrade, a fairer mien, whom I scarce saw. Yon ruffian struck me down, and spurred his horse upon me. But the beast was nobler than the man, and stoutly strove to save the creature flung beneath his heel. But in his sidelong bound inflicted here the gaping wound you see.
Shows a wound in her forehead.
Did speak of two who rode together.
Aye, the younger paused, and flung me back some gold, then followed on the track of Laurency. I set for thee, that gainst his dangerous scheming thou mightst warn thy dainty dame, but less for love of her than ancient hate of him. Begone, sir, take thy spangled fool's dress hence. I see my boy would crave his mother's blessing. Come.
Draws a brand from the fire.
I'll give it thee, my pet. My popinjay, my straight-backed gentleman.
Farewell, my mother.
Exit. A period of 10 days is supposed to elapse between scenes 1 and 3. Scene 3, a room in the manor house. Latimer, Edith.
Wouldst have me weep that with such mournful eyes thou art ever watching me? What means that gaze that since our father's death fills me so oft with some unfathomed dread? Thy happiness I would not doubt, thy love I will not. Then tell me, dear Dudley, what sad signs are these?
Edith, I blush to look in fortune's face, opening my bosom to her boundless gifts, all undeserved. What daring act hath twined with my life's garland that rich flower, thy love? How should I mate with thee, my own fair bride, but that all danger, trial, dread must now be shared with thee? I would essay some path might prove me worthier thy surpassing love, and witness how unspeakably my soul doth worship thee, its idol.
Oh, forbear, for man and sorrow are too near akin to be at distance ever.
See, I've cast the gloom and shadow of this heart on thine. Yet be it pardoned if mine eyes do wear less light of gladness, bent in thought upon the dust of a dear father, scarce inearned. Joy is but selfish.
So is sorrow, too. The heart that bows, the eyes that droop and weep o'er the fresh tomb, no grateful offering bring to the loved sleepers. Upward we must look, onward and upward.
Dearest, let us quit this theme. Thou knowest not what dark thoughts are here. Men may be prophets without angels' aid, yet thrive not by the warning. Wherefore now seems that our spring of hope is darkened o'er, its promised flowers all withering in the glare of some dark evil eye. I am not prone to superstitious credence, yet this thought clings strangely by me.
Dudley, for its soul, search thy heart closer.
There I find but thee. No shape of doubt or terror can abide so near thy throne, beloved. No, 'tis without I hear the growl of storms, which, but for thee, might burst in welcome. Could I see the end?
Now, by my hope, right glad I am, my Dudley. Thou hast, though late, bethought thee of my claim, as I partake thy sweet of thought, to share its bitter, too. Traitor! Thou givest no heart if in one little corner thou hoardst up a thought of secrecy. Too well I know with whom, and in what fatal bond some chance hath linked thy fortunes. Woman as I am, unskilled to judge the schemes of desperate men, such humble sense I have as teaches me that plots like this, with scarce a ground of hope, such loose materials, lack of earnest hands, that it may reap no honour, can but lead to loss, disgrace, perhaps, oh God, to death!
Alas, 'tis true, yet to a bitter test you put me, Edith. I am bound, indeed. And if destruction threats our toppling tower, then so much more doth honour bid me pause, nor by a cowardly desertion make its ruin sure.
Oh, not in mask so grim hide the fair face of honour.
Edith.
Aye, frown if thou wilt, I can endure it when 'tis for thyself I plead. Thy father's dust demands obedience to his living will. Whence was the light which filled his eye, till quenched by death's pale hand? What caused the smile that clung to his kind lips, e'en to the gate of death? Aye, passed beyond. But the belief that thou wast surely turning from these perilous paths, even for his sake and mine?
Spare me, my love, so much I may but promise. 3 days hence, a secret council of our band is held in the West Chamber. I will hear their plans, and if they point not fairly for success, recall my pledge. I have not told thee yet, I knew it but this morn, who brings us news from Daremberg. Our playmate, Laurency.
Thou dost not say so! Dudley, now indeed the omen speaks. Great heaven, what boding chill darts through my bosom at his very name!
Nay, he's our kinsman, and is trusted too with dearest counsels. Soon I hope to need such aid from him no more. My gentle one, be thou alone my counselor and guide, my bosom's hope and home. Oh, let me learn some fair language. I but weary thee with this heart worship, which, like some old strain, whose strength and moral in the chorus dwells, still wanders back to the old passionate tale. I love thee, and I love thee.
Exeunt. Scene 4. A Part of the Grounds. Enter Laurency and Vivian, as from a journey.
Wherefore this haste? I tell you it has cost a life. Yon gypsy whom you dashed aside so fiercely from your reign, I shrewdly guess will spell no fortunes more. Your charger's hoof left a red token on her brow will spoil the luck of many souls.
What, man? Dost fear I have marred thy fortune?
'Tis past spoiling now, though not past mending. Laugh, sir, if you will. You've killed our prophetess. I saw the blood sport forth and dim her flashing eyes that shone like witch-lights in a fen. She spoke, and seemed to know thee. Let me see, what was it she said? The Hound of Cecil.
Pshaw! Ne'er heed it!
Stay, the Hound of Cecil. Could she have discerned the warrant of thy bosom, framed against all knaves and traitors, with fit means and power to ferret out such game? How knew she that?
Pshaw! She knew nothing.
It sounds strangely, too. The Hound of Cecil. Shrew me, I have known such random shafts tell in the Golden Ring, if not the bull's-eye.
Well enough. Dost know wherefore, my friend, I sought so earnestly thy present company?
I'd fain believe to do me some good turn.
As a good turn, as if thyself hadst packed the cards. But first, I may require thine aid. Walter, thou knowest, so much thou must have gathered from my words, I am no stranger here. the buried lord of these domains, was my youth's earliest friend, but cast me from his bosom in the hour I most did need his pity.
Why? And now, like the great Roman, thou art returned to wreak thy vengeance on thy former home, and hang that home's usurping heir.
Perhaps not so. How erst thou judgest me, this breast of mine holds yet one generous tenant. The hard world that in its rough mould cast my thoughts anew left one unchanged. It was too sacred, one worth all, and that is love. Yes, there have been sweet moments when my spirit, like a bird wearied with soaring, flew to nestle here and seek amidst all sweet and peaceful things my little rosy playmate of this wood, my guardian angel. In the tented field, wrapped but in memory's mantle, I have slept and woke again, and while the storm howled by, armed with the chill mist and the biting wind, I did not feel it, Vivian.
You are moved.
Vivian, this prize was mine.
Was?
Said I so? Honor and hope rebuke me for that weak, mistrustful word. Is mine. Yet I have thought or dreamed. Didst ever hear of one who toiled in the red, thirsty summer on the bank of a fair stream and never paused to bathe his lip in the cool wave? Or one who walked o'er scattered ingots and rich gems, no hand save his to gather them, and would not stoop to fill his bosom from the glittering store? No, trust me, friend, philosophy is past. We have no such stoics now.
Crosses to Vivian.
Look in my face. Am I the man you thought me? Do I bear the look of Laurency? I that have gazed upon the fairest eyes that light the world. Blush, tremble, linger, daring not to meet this rustic child, this...
Calm yourself, my friend. She must indeed be fair to rouse thy mind to such wild action. Let us to the house. I would hear more of this strange love of thine. Didst thou not say I could give thee aid?
I'll tell thee, but not now. Mark yon old oak. Tonight, when the moon rises o'er the wood, await me there, and then will I lay open before thine eye my plans and purpose. All that this heart contains.
I shall not fail.
Exeunt. Scene 5. An apartment in the manor house. Latimer, Edith, Laurency. Laurency, aside.
I would, but cannot disenchant my eyes. She chains my gaze upon her. Gods, how fair! I knew her lovely. Dreams have limned her so. Fancy hath so presented her. But now, O artists, feeble and incapable, how are ye beggared all?
These towers, you see, retain their ancient gloom and majesty.
Laurency, starting.
Aye, in Bohemia, cousin. 'Twas there we met, aye.
Nay, I did not speak of aught beyond our ken. My thoughts were less remote than thine, good cousin. Time hath made few changes in the aspect of our home, as thou wilt find. And mine is not the hand to anticipate the scytheman's deeds, and mar this pleasant concourse of familiar things. There's little change.
I know it. Had a tree sunk down with age, or but a single stone of the old mansion changed its wonted hue, or a new flower-pot fringed the fountain's edge, I would detect it straight. My thoughts, constrained to seek another, not a fairer home, made frequent visits here, though stealthy too, for I have found that pleasant memory, one of the heart's spoiled children, o'er-indulged, doth tax the bosom for a greater love that wisdom should accord. Dear Latimer, here is a comrade for whose sake I must...
Enter Vivian.
Bespeak your kindness. one with whom the world or its worst part hath dealt ungratefully. He bears, you see, no malice. On his front a generous nature shines.
Aside.
Oh, most demure.
He retires abruptly. Latimer and Vivian conversing.
And smiling priestess, sits thy worship there? Love, who can doubt thine aspect, whether locked in mute lips, and the soft hypocrisy of eyes that droop and wander, or as thus, all bare and speaking as an alehouse sign? See how her breath waits on his words. Her eye follows the bend of his. I cannot breathe with freedom here. Come, loitering knight, I long, I sicken for thee. Dudley, can it be? Lo, how the rosy, laughing boy hath leaped into the pride and power of noble manhood. Down, courtier heart, thy flattery out of tune. Try, candor, and confess a woman's love might ask no fairer boon on such head to lavish its rich treasure. I grow sick. I'll forth and walk, for better far to gaze on souls that float in the red streams of hell than longer on this pair.
Exit.
Had aught occurred in your late travel that could throw this cloud of discontent athwart my kinsman's brow?
No, truly, sir. He ne'er seemed merrier. These lovely scenes called many a pleasant hour back to his mind. No warrior in the field, lover to bridal, schoolboy to his home, e'er showed more gamesome mood. Stay, I remember some hag of the forest yonder seized his rein, whom, while she spoke, his restless beast threw down, and hurt, I fear. 'Tis like his generous heart dwells on it strongly.
Aside.
What a friend am I.
Re-enter Lorenzi.
Your pardon, cousin. I've ta'en the right of an old friend, to quit you at my will, a foe that I had hoped to leave behind in the damp fields of Holland haunts me still. A sudden faintness, which the calm fresh air doth medicine quickly. It is gone, quite gone, and so no more I pray you. You shall find my spirits rise the freelier from their thrall.
Latimer leads him to Edith.
Come, I must have you better friends with one who shared alike our boyish sport and care. Nay, I must fain confess, in frolic still, the readiest of the three.
Aside.
So grave, my Edith? A word, good Master Vivian.
They talk apart.
Edith, may I call you so? My lips have not been taught as yet forgetfulness of any word so fondly loved. Am I forgotten, Edith? Is all forgotten? All the pleasant scenes that were so dear, the rose walk and the bower, the tale of witch and fairy conned beside the gossiping brook. Nay, and you will, or no, I'll play the tutor to your memory, which doth put on this dull and careless garb in very wilfulness. Thou canst not choose but think.
There's naught in childish joys to fill that spot of richest culture marked by heaven for nobler fruitage. Our maturer thought sweeps brightly o'er the mind's expanding scroll, and wisdom on the ready surface writes in characters more loved and lasting too.
Oh, do not preach so harsh a faith. Drag not the fabric down in whose kind shade this outcast soul hath sheltered from despair, nor with such cruel sorcery transform memory's bright gold to ashes. Must the heart crown its fair mansions with new tenants, stern and world-polluted, yet refuse its first, its innocent guests, a home? What I had died ere wandered back to find such heart as thine turned from its woman's truth and tenderness.
I am not changed. And since you challenge truth, then blame me not for its unwelcome mien. I loved the roses then. I love them now, armed as they stand, their tiny points shew fair and patent to the eye. The fount, the bird, have the same melody so loved of old. They cannot pander the sweet gift of song to falsehood's purposes. No changeling, I. What I have loved, I love. What hated, and such fault shall lack no advocate in heaven, I from my heart abhor. And that is one who hides a dark and treacherous intent in pleasant seeming, sends his malice forth, dressed in the robes of friendship. Latimer, thy friends must need refreshment. Will you follow?
Crosses and gives her hand to Vivian, who leads her out.
You are not well yet. To some inward pang your changing cheek confesses.
Then my cheek shows falsest colours forth. Tut, I ne'er felt so well content, so boisterously gay, so well disposed to cast all thought beside, and give my soul to reckless merriment. I've a song and tale for thee. We'll e'en be boys again, my cousin. Come, we loiter. Come.
Exeunt. End of the first act.
This audiobook is brought to you by Full Audiobooks. Please like, subscribe, and click the bell icon if you love audiobooks.
Act 2 of The Lords of Ellingham by Henry Spicer. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Act 2, Scene 1, a part of the grounds at a short distance from the house. Lorenzi, alone.
To light between the maddened hunter and his yielding quarry were a perilous, albeit a timely leap. 'Tis done, and now my soul is arming for a task more hard, to make the prey my own. Ah, hither wends the ready instrument, that graceless fool, who, when the minion fortune came and crammed her partial favours in his very maw, did spit them from him.
Enter Vivian.
Vivian, what? Is't thou? A friendly step ever has music in it, else truly I should chide that thou didst break so rudely on my dream. I was enwrapped in heavenly musings. See yon glimmering world. Is not a sweet and comfortable faith to deem her pure white orb that home contains, where spirits long athirst for waters free from the eternal taint of life's alloy may stoop and drink their fill.
Chaw, is this the mighty secret? Then with your good leave I'll go home to supper. There's a flask worth all the streams thou talk'st of that I left but barely finished. What's the moon to me?
'Tis well. Thou clipp'st the spirit's eagle wings, and back to earth it falls. Aye, to the task, the daily drudgery of creeping life, bind we our thoughts again. Now then, my friend, for so thou art, I have a thing to do, a work of gain and promise. In one word, say, wilt thou aid me?
Why, sir, I am poor.
Poor art thou? I bethink me of a vale midway twixt Atherton and Goldingham, lovely and fertile, whose fat soil, men said, yielded the flower or the harvest. Those broad fields, where are they?
In a needy moment sold for one good acre's worth. Nettles and weeds, black poisonous mists, blighting and barrenness enshroud them. Let them go.
The forest, too? Stout oak and fir? Why, man, 'tis very gold. Sell and be rich.
They're ploughing the salt seas. God's malison on every fated ship they help to furnish.
But the good doubloons, rich plunder, gathered in the Spanish wars. Sure, those fair hoards, won by thy gallant sire with hazard of his blood, were never doomed to hang in pearls upon a wanton's neck, or gild the thousand graceless purposes of an unthrifty son.
They're gone, sir, gone. The glittering cherubs got them wings, and ere I knew their beauty, fled in different shapes, as gems, rich garments, banquets, women, wine, hawks, horses, dogs. The dice, perchance, have had their turn. It was slight. I never cared to gain. My gift was spending. Glorious days were they. Hey, I think my stars, I have lived, sir, well.
That thou mightst die a beggar in a ditch, a wise resolve. But even thus we prove, and quickly too, the worth of that rare gem, an unbought friendship. Doubtless those who sat with thee in fortune's lap drank thy free cup, and shared the bounty which thy frank heart gave so richly forth, did welcome in the cloud which brought them opportunity to pay their honor's debt, and give thee refuge fair, till brighter days should shine.
Good sooth, sir, not they. Knowing far, the pretty butterflies fled to a sunnier clime, deserting one whose flowers had fallen.
And left you?
Very poor.
True, so thou art, and what the sons of men, in their great wisdom, think their opulence. But there's another sort. That breeze was kind that scattered thine inheritance. It blew thy smouldering wit to flame. The courage, too, a bird that crows so stoutly, hath ere now bloodied his beak. Mark me, how fair a field for gifts like these doth niggard man bestow. His grovelling passion, his blind lust, false pride, his love, ha ha, his fond credulity. These are thy acres, and thy forests too, thy jewels and thy money bags. To this, what is the doting alchemist's false dream, the merchant's freight, their heirs? Pooh! I have shown thee the true Golconda.
What wouldst have me do?
Work but this mine. 'Tis easy. Come this way. Thou seest this path whereon we stand?
I do.
How like a cunning serpent it doth glide, now stretching on in the full eye of day, now piercing the wood's bosom. Lo, 'tis gone, we know not where, yet there it is again, still winding on towards yon princely pile. And look you now, its two huge arms expand as if to grasp the prize. Such path is mine. Such the reward I aim at.
How? Reward? Young Latimer's inheritance?
Aye, more than his inheritance. No matter now, whate'er it be, I tell thee, it will repay the toil. Remember only, those who climb to a great end not often find the path too smooth for them.
Tut, sir, no child am I, no trembling girl.
Aye, but your high-blood steed, that tosses his proud head and stamps in scorn amid the spears, will swerve and start aside, scared by a skulking crone. Remember this. Take we our warning from the princely beast. No check at shadows.
You speak darkly. Yet my mind, methinks, goes with you.
If I said our way had crooked turnings which require eyes that wink not beneath suspicion's gaze, prompt hands that start not from the transient touch of needful blood.
I know its color. Well?
Nay, there's no more to say, and 'tis but chance, mere chance, true metal's touchstone. Thou art then prepared to aid me?
With most earnest will. I'd fain build up my shattered hopes anew, and from the top look down, and laugh at those who thought my ruin sure. I'd better learn to entertain them. There's no gratitude in this great mart, the world. Ah, who goes there?
Gargantua crosses behind them.
'Tis the dwarf page. Think'st thou the hunchback thief hath heard our talk?
I care not. Let us in. We will no longer company the stars, lest they should mingle in our council too.
Exeunt. Scene 2. A summer parlor. Edith alone. Edith pushes her harp aside.
I cannot recollect it, yet 'tis strange. The perfect music that doth haunt my ear prompts not my memory. So to forget a thing he loves. My heart is ill at ease. Pass but this day in safety, I shall smile at the slight birth of weak and foolish fears that, like two eager sentinels, create a foe in each new object. Who is there? My page!
Enter Gargantua.
Come hither, sir, and tell me why of late thou art ever absent, though thy place is at thy mistress's side. I thought you loved me.
Loved, lady?
Foolish boy, why dost thou start and crimson thus?
I know not. I feared your anger, ma'am.
Anger? Art thou not most true and faithful?
Once to prove that faith is the rich gem that sends a lustre up through life's dull draught. I'll find it, though it lie beneath the dregs. But see, a guest approaches, whose courtly tones are better skilled to charm a lady's ear.
Enter Lorenzi.
One word, beseech you.
Hast thou aught to say that touches but myself? Speak it, I pray, without reserve.
Lorenzi, going.
There was another name might have claimed some attention, but perchance a more auspicious hour.
Gargantua, I'll summon thee again.
Exit Gargantua.
First of thyself, wherefore this studied coldness, these austere and altered looks? What fatal hand cast this icy barrier twixt the intercourse of once familiar bosoms? Trust me, Edith, I would do much to win that kindness back was mine in happier days.
Wouldst thou indeed?
Indeed, indeed I would.
Why listen, then, for I will tax thy generosity, and that right speedily. I know thee, sir, thee and thine errand here. 'Tis one of craft, of false deceit, of black-souled treachery, of that foul crime which men who boast their guilt would ne'er confess to, the lost angel's fault, ingratitude. Throw down the slight disguise. Do I not know thee?
Lorenzi, aside.
Better hadst thou been a thought less wise.
Aloud.
I know not from what act, what word of mine the knowledge grew, which bears so dark an aspect. I am not affrighted with a black picture quickly conjured up to turn me from my suit. Come, lady, come, a truce to irony. Thy words but now bade me believe, or else mine heart, too skilled to snatch at hope, deceived me, that there was some way, albeit I find it not, whereby this long and patient and enduring love might reap at length reward.
Did I say so? I had forgotten. Yes, there is one way. Wouldst find it?
Aye, fair lady, willingly.
Thy palfrey stands within his wonted stall. 'Tis a stout nag and swift. Will travel well some 20 miles, ere noon be ripe tomorrow. Be thus far on toward the capital. Be silent as to all thou mayest have heard and noted here. Return not for the space of one whole year. Then I will school my mind, confess that I have judged thee hastily, entreat thy pardon, and bestow...
Lorenzi, taking her hand eagerly.
Speak, speak!
Edith turns away.
My gratitude and cousinly esteem.
Truly a generous and prudent pledge. Yet do I covet more, for thine own sake, for life's, for honour's, for the sake of all thou hold'st as precious, last of all, for mine. Say not despair. Oh, put not to the test the frailty of this heart, nor set at strife gratitude, mercy, and the love of thee, lest that the last prevail. See, fate has laid her sharpest weapons ready to my hand, and fair occasion courts me. Nay, no more. Throw this ill-fitting garb of anger by. Resume thy smile. Be gentle to my suit. And, even at mine own peril, these thy friends, though far advanced in treason's dangerous march, shall be, by friendly hands, drawn back and saved. Reject me, and they perish. With a boy whose blood is worth them all. Do not speak yet. Pause on the final doom.
To pause was sin greater than I can name. Hark! For my friends I leave them to their innocence and God, but for that dearer life you threaten, know he is. My heart throbs proudly at the word. He is my husband.
Lorenzi, starting back.
Jest not on this theme. Nay, were it this, had I been so betrayed, some rumour must have reached my tortured ear, e'en in my land of exile. Speak again, say that thou dost but prove me.
It is true, I am his wedded wife.
Lorenzi, after a pause.
And thou canst smile, canst speak, with tone unaltered, words that tear the fibres of my heart. Art thou a woman? No, no. Her soul's first element is love, her nature's essence, mercy. She ne'er turns her back on the neglected, tramples not upon the fallen. Honour is her god, and her high creed, how sorely tried soe'er, forbids to wrong the absent. Edith, thou wert mine, by promise, in the face of heaven, I ne'er released the bond.
It is too late.
It is not. To my passion, this boy's love was but a childish dream. Oh, wretch! Oh, thief! What in a brother's absence couldst creep in and steal his toil's reward? Edith, for thee I have risked more than labor. Thou hast sate even in mine honor's throne, hast worn the garb of virtue woven in angel looms. Thy hand hath weaved the cheering light no cloud could hide, storm quench, no danger pale. Have mercy, Edith. Rend off these fatal fetters. Mine thou art, and mine I swear thou shalt be.
What is this? Dost thou not know me? Didst not hear my word, the wife of Latimer?
Hold, torturer! Be still! It burns my soul. I know thee. Thou art a felon's bride, and I would save thee from ills thou darest not meet in dreams. Come, come, did I not swear it?
Either thou art vile beyond all scorn, or I most wickedly pervert thy meaning. By my hopes of heaven, I blush to spend another word on thee. Yet know that I disdain thy threatened power, even as I loathe thy love.
She retires as he approaches.
Kneel at my feet, and I will spurn thee as a venomous thing that, in the guise of friendly innocence, would sting my more than life. Avoid my path, coward and ingrate.
These are courteous words, and for infliction of a deadly wrong, a balm well chosen. Once again, be warned. Send me not from you with these poisonous thoughts warring upon my reason. Urge me not to madness. Edith, speak! Hast not one word of comfort?
None. Pity dwells not with scorn. I know thee for a spy, a creature hired to traffic in the blood of nobler men. And yet I fear thee not. Be grateful that I leave thee thus. Nor bid some vassal's hand chastise this vain presumption.
Exit.
Ha, ha, ha! Chastise! Presumption! Mercy! Mercy! Heaven! Let not this fearful passion burst my brain and thus defraud me of my last dear aim. A swift and deep revenge!
A pause. He looks up suddenly.
Who spoke to me? What shapes are these that float upon mine eyes, glide o'er the landscape, glitter from the tree, inviting as to some rich banquet, each with aspect fairer than his fellow? Ha! With what fair craftiness ye choose your time! Such should not tempt in vain. I know you all. Ye smiling fiends and ministers of hell, whence ye arise, and whither lead I know, and who is your master? Still, with heart enslaved by your surpassing mane, and promise kind, I make ye mine, and follow. Come, revenge, come, sweet revenge, swift hope for once outrun. Or not I'll shrink, so it be but quickly done.
Rushes out. Scene 3. A retired part of the grounds. Walter Vivian reclining listlessly on a bench.
This will not do. I must shake off this calm that steals like some deceitful foe on one whose life is action. Yet 'tis sweet. Above, blue sleeping skies, and in mine ears alone the brooklet's distant murmur, or the buzz of summer insects. Would I were a fly, a soft and gentlemanly life he leads, with not on earth a duty or a care, save to make music to the flowers, and take their honey for his pains. With day he dies. Night is too chill for his luxurious ease, too rough for his gentility. Hey, ho, who would not be a fly? And this sword, whose weight I ne'er yet felt, grows ponderous to my hand as any ploughshare. Oh, pooh, my very thoughts grow rustic now.
Enter Laurenzi in a disordered manner. He paces up and down, as not noticing Vivian.
Do spirits walk at noon? Hast met a ghost and listened to some tale of direful murder? Speak, companion.
Thou here?
Aye. What has happened? What contains the scroll you crush so madly?
Lost, lost, lost! The prize long hoped, long promised, gone! O Walter, wast thou that jested at our travel's speed? Alas, the horses should be winged at heel that must outgallop human treachery.
What? She refused you?
No, a puling boy, a whining, sickly minion, of whose life, till 3 days past, I took nor thought nor heed, hath snatched my prize as you would a thistledown, and whiffed it from me. Her own lips pronounced the fatal truth. I wept, I kneeled, I prayed, I know not what, for I was mad. She bent upon me eyes that flashed disdain and rage, and left me with a threat that, well, 'tis well. I woo another now. Dear Vivian, one thou must help me to. I did not think so soon to need thy promised aid. Take this.
Gives a scroll.
I would have written something, but can trace no characters that man may read. Mine eyes dazzle and throb. Beneath my writhing hand, the letters turn to blood. Now pray you, hence, take my good horse, Grey Champney, and away. George Bagot lies at Malwood with his troop, not 10 miles hence. Away!
My mission first. What must I do?
Oh, pardon. In this scroll, it bears the seal of Cecil. Thou wilt write such names as Griffin Markham, Farningham, Brooke, Peyton, Parham, and Latimer. Tonight, the witch of discontent doth hold high counsel here, and hither come her sons in strange disguises as their fancies teach, fitter for Morris dance than council grave, for mask than murder, choicest plotters they. Oh, I could laugh, but for a demon thought that burns me. Here, let Bagot draw his men about the door, and when my rapier falls, unleash thy bloodhounds and secure them.
All?
All I have named. Dost understand me?
Aye, but I have ate and drank with Latimer, looked in his heart, and now to hang him? Think of the poor girl, too. Nay, my conscience shuns this act of...
Stern justice, thou wouldst say. I'll help thee to the word. Tax as thou wilt my grateful friendship. Glut thyself with gold. Make life a revel. Sit in luxury's lap. Play with coy fortune's golden tress, and those thy friends that bowed them to the noonday sun, but shunned its setting. Thou dost mind me? Ha! Wilt now reward them?
Sir, enough. Your slave.
Exit.
So, the dark play begins. With every pulse I feel my nature change. What darksome spell, what fearful spirit is at work within when even external objects do partake its horrid seeming? Edith, 'tis thy deed, not mine. No, not mine.
Exit. Scene 4. a large apartment in the western wing. Latimer, Farningham, Peyton, Rook, Sir Griffin Markham, and others, carelessly disguised, sitting as in deliberation.
Pshaw, tell me not. And 'twere not for the pity to strike one link from out so fair a chain of fellowship, it were but just to move the name of Matthew Lawrency be marked within our list, as lukewarm in the cause of honour and of truth. Believe me, sirs, I like it not, spite of his pleasant mien. I hold him far too close and crafty, far to trust our necks withal.
And by the chain, wherewith thine own is compassed, thou, methinks, valuest it over cheaply. Hast, perchance, escaped thy wisdom, that thou art not now lord of the hall and bower in Farmingham, but simply Hob the ploughman? At what tryst didst buy thy gewgaw?
Spanish leather boots, bright gilded spurs, and jewel-hilted dagger, make an apt finish to a butcher's frock and rusty beaver. I will be so bold, worshipful wielder of the axe and steel, to bid thee doff such tell-tale braveries and leave them in the shambles.
Gentle swain, most rustic Damon.
Good sheep-slaughterer, tempt not thy bullock's fate, or...
Ha! Huh. How now? Here is a coil betwixt two honest men, the butcher and the boor. Our friends have yet to learn disguises. We who breathe in courts, we are sworn maskers. The world finds us ever what we would be, not what we are.
Rook, aside to Farningham.
Lo, now, Sir Griffin Markham, 15th page of state, deputy usher of the Queen's backstairs, mounts his court palfrey. You shall hear anon the very words the Lady Clarice Mayne whispered the Duchess in the presence chamber that made her stiff grace smile. Wouldst know how oft the King caressed his poodle? He will tell you these news and more, and for all rumours, sooth, commend me to these know-alls who know nothing, who skim the airy froth of circumstance, but leave the cream behind.
E'en so, and yet the scale that holds our common venture, Brook, is not so laden now, but we must needs be thankful to the very butterfly that perches on the beam.
How set you then the life of our great enterprise upon the faith of this court rapier?
He is brave, and has the useful knowledge those acquire who, mingling with the puppets of the time, note the great game, and shape their lesser one after the winning rule.
Aloud.
But this is strange. The trysting time is past. Yon empty seat doth augur badly for our brotherhood. What, can the blossoms of our sprouting tree drop off so quickly?
'Twas my own remark, friend Latimer. I tell thee to thy beard. Thou nursest carelessly our infant cause. I do mistrust this friend of D'Arenberg, whoe'er he be.
Rest you contented, sir. I have no longing for a hempen ruff more than yourself. And give me leave to say, if freely I confide to this man's hand my life, as deeply gauged as any here, why, so may you.
Thou'lt answer for his truth? Well, I am satisfied.
So am not I. Nay, I demand.
Enter Lorenzi, speaking to one without.
I tell thee, sirrah, no. Hence, I will do thy message. Cousin Dudley, here was some man of thine before the door, a most importunate knave, who would intrude upon these worthy gentlemen to bring a pressing embassy from thy fair bride.
From Edith? Ha!
That thou must keep in mind to ride with her tomorrow, else she would believe something, I know not what.
To business. Now, may no half-heart friends delay our deeds, nor discord mar our counsels. Let us first consult our letters. What says D'Arenberg?
Marry, but little to the point. He writes as if the paper were red-hot, and he dreaded to burn his fingers. A wise hound that doth not care to open till the game be fairly sprung.
A moment, gentlemen. There is a little custom, a mere form. 'Tis only a mere form, grace before meat, yet still 'twere well. Our new ally, who deigns at length to fill his seat, hath not yet ta'en our wonted pledge.
Is it thus you spend your time at council board?
The others speak apart.
Nay, sirs, mistake me not, nor deem that I refuse to share in aught your wisdom hath enacted.
Enter hastily at a side door, one closely muffled.
Watson, then is danger near?
Nay, brothers, I am here to quicken, not to quench your noble zeal in our fair lady's cause. Pray you, sit down, while briefly I unfold a project framed by those you wot of, but which your own hands must render perfect. 10 days hence, the king will hunt at Hanworth. Shall we too be there, and pay our homage?
How? Unbidden?
Aye, and unexpected, and unwished. The king at Hanworth hunts the deer, but we will hunt the king. The royal hart once snared, we make our own conditions with a meaner herd. Exalt our gentle lady, set men free to worship as their conscience will, and work our full revenge on Hume and Cecil. Speak, like you the sport?
A silence.
Why, aye, but something doubt its due enjoyment. Our whole strength would scarce bring down the royal quarry turned to bay. Yet hold, how rides the monarch?
With a band of 30 yeoman foresters. Of those, some are our own, the rest but lightly armed with hunting spear and knife. We'll scarce resist determined onset. What, my friends? Ye pause, as I had bade you to besiege the tower, not take a summer's ride. Well, well, enough. Let me not urge you. To another theme. We'll talk of this again. Now hear the tale of high rewards that wait on our success.
The schedule framed by Raleigh?
Aye, 'tis here, and you will find that he whose name should stand the foremost there hath claimed no meed but honor. Unto myself has fallen the lot which claims my best of service, Lord High Chancellor, the noble Cobham's kinsman, Master Brooke, Lord Treasurer of England. Next to him, Sir Griffin Markham, first in court intrigue, quick to resources. Why so fit is he for our state secretary? Last, not least, the good Lord Grey, our master of the horse, England's Earl Marshal.
There's one other post, and much I marvel that the highest of all be left untenanted.
What, sir, is that?
The officer of hangman. Gentlemen, if I mistake not, we shall have quick need of such a functionary. I, too, beg to read my schedule.
He produces a paper, which Laurenti snatches and tears.
Matthew Laurency, thou art a traitor and a villain.
All rise in confusion.
How? A Judas here? The soft-faced flatterer. How well he played his part. And yet, methinks, he hath not lived at court.
Now, hear me, sirs. While here we sit, dispensing place and pay, honours and titles, by this comrade here, our lives are bought and sold. Look here, and here.
Points to the writing.
From this torn witness we may gather still what will convict a traitor. Draw, sir spy.
Advances upon Laurenti, who is searching for his weapon. Latimer, placing himself between them.
Stay, sirs. Stand back. What sudden broil is here? How know you he betrayed us? There's no proof. Hither he came, a voluntary guest, and he shall have fair trial. Hold, I say.
Strikes down Faringham's rapier. The door is forced open, and Bagot rushes in with soldiers.
Secure the window. Let no bird escape. A brimming trapful.
Peyton, to the guards.
Let me pass, good friends. Alack, I knew not what disloyal mouths I came to measure for tomorrow's feast.
Good Master Butcher, stay, not quite so fast. Let us not lose your worship's company. The tower hath roomy offices wherein, by leave of your kind sovereign, thou mayst still pursue thy honest calling. Fellows, look, Let him not pass, him in the fisher's frock. 'Tis Griffin Markham.
So thou knowest mine heir? Know too, Sir Soldier, we who breathe in courts can do the swordplay.
Draws.
Are we in the toils? Let's prove the birds have talons, then. Come on, draw, friends, and try the temper of your steel. Rapier to partisan.
All draw.
Hold, hold, hot boy, for your brave father's sake, whose loyal heart death spared this bitter pang. I will not drench his ancient hall in blood. Our threefold force spurns all resistance. Drop your rebel swords, trust your king's mercy, rather than contend idly against his justice.
Farningham, to the guards who secure them.
Careless hounds, ye are fit tools of justice, thus to leave the better part undone. What? Stands he there?
Pointing to Lorenzi.
The master spirit of our enterprise, watching the tower his own false fingers planned, drop on the builders' heads? Must he go free to forge fresh plots, while those more innocent are marked for felons?
Sir, my soldiers know the duty brought them here. The list of those whose practices have drawn the wakeful eye of justice on them shows me not the name of him you mention.
Farningham to Latimer.
Hear you that, my friend? Now own me for a prophet.
Enter Vivian. Vivian, aside to Lorenzi.
You were slow in giving signal.
I had lost my weapon, and theirs were at my throat. But he saved me, and gave himself the signal of his doom. 'Tis well he spared me that. Keep further off. Quick eyes observe us.
Gentlemen, I must pursue my office. Such kind care as may render the time less galling shall be yours where I command. Lead on.
As they are led out, Edith enters, and throws herself upon the neck of Latimer.
Look up, my girl. Show me thine eyes. Even from those stars of hope must I win fortitude to bear that ill their loving foresight would have turned from me, not learn in idle sorrow.
Let me weep. I am a woman. What imputed crime draws these dark faces round us?
My worst fault is the imprudence that has brought this grief on thee, beloved. Some enemy has sown these jealous poisons in our life's fair fields. But they shall bloom again, love, doubt it not. Fear not mine innocence.
I will not. No, they cannot harm thee.
Lady, pardon me, this thankless office. We must forth. But soon, my friend, I trust, shall know no prison save the arms which hold him now.
Signs to Lorenzi aside.
Persuade her hence. I must away.
Take courage, gentle cousin. Come, shall I lead you in?
Ha! Touch me not, thou viper! Hence! Oh, Dudley, we are lost! The enemy is here!
She sinks into Latimer's arms, insensible.
This is the worst. Curse on my madness. What are gems and thrones to the blessed peace whose empire ruined lies in this kind bosom?
He pauses, then beckons Lorenzi.
Cousin, hark, a word. Closer, come closer. Fix thine eyes on mine. A dark suspicion rests upon thee. Tongues have freely used thy name. But I am slow to see the cloud I would not, and prefer, by greater love and fuller trust, to shame a fleeting honor back. Look what is here.
Points to Edith.
A thing how loved, how helpless, and how fair, unused to sorrow's sting. I think thee honest. I know that thou'rt a man. Wilt watch this treasure? Wilt guard her with all truth and tenderness, and soothe and strengthen when my danger comes? For, cousin, there is danger. Say but aye, and take her from mine arms, a gem to be returned me here as pure, or else redeemed with added grace in heaven. But if thou dost mistrust thyself, nay, search thy heart, good cousin, and if thou find'st one faint and wavering thought, then give me back mine own, and boldly say that heart, though weak, is yet too great to wrong the friend that trusted thee.
Be witness heaven. I take the pledge, and will defend it so that when thou art free thou shalt suspect no more, but know me as I am.
Takes Edith in his arms and gives her to attendants who bear her out.
Our horses wait. Set forward there.
With your permission, sir, I'll journey with you. When a tempest lowers above the heads I love, 'tis not my wont to quit their side. No, I'll to London too,
and there partake the fortune, good or ill, of my dear friend and cousin, Latimer.
Your presence may be needed. At the least, your friend will have good counsel. Much I hope this boyish plot will finish, as it ought, rather in jest than blood.
Exeunt all but Laurenti and Vivian.
Was it well managed?
The most diligent fiend in Satan's train could make no better speed, but a lost soul just turning back to heaven that had been deemed secure. 'Tis done. No more. I bargained with thee, not for praise, but gold. Thou shalt not lose thy hire. Hold, hark you.
Well?
Dost thou believe? Pshaw, 'tis a foolish thought. Untimely, too. But tell me, dost believe that this life ended? On its heels there treads another, and more lasting?
Truly, aye, if you believe priests' tales.
A judgment, too, where man, before a thousand waking worlds, must stand uncounseled and alone to plead for crimes committed against his fellow?
Vivian, turning from him.
Why these questions now?
Because, if so it be, mark me, I say, but if this spiteful deed we are in act to do will show so strong midst the more colorable vice of men, veiled as we will, its scarlet shall blush through and drag down justice.
What? So soft of heart? Wast thou not mocked?
Give me thine hand, good friend. 'Tis very true. What strange forgetfulness. Yes, I was mocked. Thank God that I was mocked, insulted, spurned. I know thou didst not heed my fond and idle talk. No, no, thou didst not. Thou art my good friend. Come on, we'll follow them.
Exeunt. End of the second act.
This audiobook is brought to you by Full Audiobooks. Please like, subscribe, and click the bell icon if you love audiobooks.
Act 3 of The Lords of Ellingham by Henry Spicer. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Act 3, Scene 1, a cell in the old jail of Winchester. Latimer, conducted by Hugh Kensel and others.
Show me thy lantern, friend. Scant light is here for one whose footsteps are not wont, like thine, to probe so deeply the mysterious paths delved in earth's bosom.
When you quit them, sir, light may yet be more odious. Randolph, see those rivets, sure.
How, fellows, you mistake. I am no bear, nor lion newly snared. Such fetters are not forged for manly limb, and shall not hang on mine.
Your office, sirs. Heed you a snarling cur that hath no teeth to back his puny rage? Up with him straight, secure, but not too close. Give room to reach the couch. Aye, let no tight tether mar his soft repose.
As they secure him, enter Marion with a basket. Marion, passing near Latimer.
Be patient, sir. You know not yet with whom you deal.
So, that will do. What dainty mistress! You have brought some food to make our new guest welcome? What hast here?
Examining the basket.
Are these the viands we are wont to spread before our visitors? Child, you mistake. Black bread and water is the traitor's fare.
Pardon, my father. He is gently bred, has had soft nurture. Never hath he known, alas, that any should, the hardships born in this dark world.
Dost teach me my duty, wench? Nay, take the hint. Be gone.
Marion, aside to him.
Beseech you, sir.
Kensel, with sudden rage.
What, minion? Dare you answer me?
He seizes her by the hair.
Hands off, old savage. Would you kill her? Every hair you grasp is worth thy carcass. Could I reach thee? Curse on these chains! Release her, brute!
Rail on. This warmth of passion will be curbed anon. The crawling cell-damp hath a wondrous knack at curing sudden tempers. Look, sir boy, how much Hugh Kensell fears your worship's rage.
Beats Marion.
Oh, father, do not strike me! Pray you, sir, incense him not. Rage ever masters him. Release me, father, I'll obey you. Oh!
Enter Laurenti. Laurenti seizes Marion from him.
How now, Black Hugo? At thy favorite sport, old keeper of hell gates, are scourge and chain the only music grateful to thy soul? Shame on you, coward! What art muttering? Hither, you growling ruffian!
Whispers Kensell, who withdraws sullenly to the back of the cell.
My poor. Nay, nay. Be comforted.
My heart is full. I will go in and watch by my poor child. And thou wilt come to me?
I will come. But I have business with my kinsman, which 'twere cruel to delay. He needs a friend as well as thou. What cheer, good cousin? Nay!
Exit Marion.
What have we here?
Examining Latimer's chains.
A pleasant-visaged friend. Doth thy profession no auxiliaries own of fairer mould than these? Unlock them straight. Thou dost exceed thy duty.
Kensell brings a light chain.
It is well. And now my limbs have space and strength to move. Keep thou beyond their range. Welcome, my friend.
Sit down, dear cousin. I must talk with thee. And get thee hence, old bandog. What dost here? Thine office once performed.
Exit Kensell.
By what strange spell dost awe the savage nature of this fiend? 'Twere well to teach it me.
The love of life. There's blood upon his soul. And well he knows I have his secret. Such a wholesome fear proves useful now. The villain hath, beside, a daughter fair and gentle. For her sake he shall not hang. Enough of him. Which tear of Edith?
I but hover round my mark, dreading to strike at knowledge, which may fix fresh sadness here. Yet speak.
When first aroused from out the kind oblivion which affords heart's breathing time, she gave herself to grief that awed all comfort dumb. She took no food nor slept, but paced from hall to hall, and sighed in answer to their echoes. Then her mood changed, and the mourner thenceforth wore her grief with proud, calm constancy, as if wound up to some most fixed resolve. Start not, dear cousin, but much I fear this seeming fortitude betokens harm.
To whom?
Thou know'st that some, in prosperous hours, most weak and womanly, that start at shadows, shrink with mortal dread from sorrow's slightest contact, will, when struck by an overwhelming grief, brace up each nerve to sudden courage. Edith hath prevailed with certain disaffected men on whom, and on their plans, most jealous eyes are nailed, to meet in silence, and with sudden force attempt your rescue. Who can tell what harm this love, whose deep devotion shows so fair, might drag upon its object.
Blessed fault! 'Tis hard to blame its rashness. How to check this harm?
Alas, my poor intervention fails, unused to cope with.
Stay, a letter, cousin. Write words of comfort. Bid her note how things that bow them to the sweeping storm rise up with fresher state. Tell her how dear is life. Be earnest there, and bid her seek to save by swift compliance, patience, gentleness, rather than dangerous schemes. Had she a friend?
Who but thyself? What, gave I not this gem unto thy guardianship? And thou, false friend, forsak'st the trust so soon.
So speed me heaven, as I will never leave to guard this prize, even as it were mine own.
Aside.
The devil himself, methinks, can wring no falsehood out of that. I must depart, my cousin, but will leave a trusty friend to whom thou mayst confide the letter. So take comfort and farewell.
Farewell, and thanks for your good counsel, cousin.
Exit Lorenzi. Scene 2. A meanly furnished room in the jailer's house. Marion watching by her child asleep.
He's quiet now. That restless cry no more grates on my heart. The bright, unhealthy rose burns with less luster. Kind physician, sleep. What balm can equal thine?
Sings in a low tone.
My sleeping boy, thy form this eve, so near my heart I bear. Almost I dread thou shouldst perceive the doubt that rankles there. I dare not kiss thee should I weep. My tears would break thy gentle sleep. But I can guard thy slumber well and pray for thee, my boy. Pray that no scorn thy love repel, no blight thy hope destroy. One was my love and hope, and he is cold and stern and changed to me.
Out on my tongue! I know not why this discontented strain, this silly rhyme, should haunt me ever thus, when I'd be merry. There's a time for grief, and that is when the loved are far away, not looked for momently. There is a time for joy, and surely that is when kind looks and treasured words, like visitors who know how welcome is their coming, boldly knock at memory's mansion. Loving guests, come in. There's room for all. And have I not, beside, good hope that he will grant the boon that now I put to issue?
Bends over her child and sings again as if unconsciously. Enter Lorenzi.
What? So doleful, child? Hast not a merrier?
Marion, rushing to him.
Hush, dear Lorenzi. The baby sleeps at last. The fever fit hath worn him sadly. Heaven be praised thou art come. I've much to say to thee.
Then quickly, girl. I must away again. My horses wait.
Come, look upon the little slumberer. Soft, soft, I pray you. It hath cost such pains to win him to the sleep. Oh, Lorenzi, looks he not lovely? Sweet my boy, sleep on, my own heart's darling. Prithee, rest a while. Let me sit here and lean this throbbing brow upon thy knee. I would not see thine eyes, for if I looked and found rejection there, midst the wild tumult of my eager hope, methinks 'twould kill me.
Tears, poor child? Come, come, out with this dreadful tale. Hast stolen a cake and had a whipping?
Mock not at my woes, for that were worse than still to suffer them. I am most wretched. Take me from this place, and keep the pledge you gave.
Pshaw, the old tale. The weary, sad old tale.
Alas! Alas, thou knowest not half the misery I bear. My father hates me, Lorenzi. 'Tis true, that sense which in the sternest parent's heart hath some dominion hath been changed to gall, to scorn, to loathing. Foul, contemptuous words and blows, less hard to bear. Look here, and here, these limbs you praised for whiteness, you will scarce say so again. These tangled locks you said were bright and soft, now rudely rent away in his fierce anger. Worse than that,
Oh, God! My child! He struck my child, even as it stretched its little arms and would have flown to him, had he permitted. Pity! I can bear this weary hope no longer.
Thou sayst well, and from the burden of this hope I will at once relieve you. Thou canst never be my lady wife. Didst e'er believe, my pet, for all my vows but kindly meant to give thy conscience ease, that, ha, 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 I'd wed the headsman's daughter? For that silken snare which binds so many discontented hearts, I'll give thee gold. I'll give thee what must... Well? Why dost thou turn so pale and clutch mine arm?
Forgive me. I am faint. I scarcely think I understand you.
When in former days I talked of love, thou wast not wont to be so slow of comprehension. Plainly, then, thou hast no longer hold upon my heart, save for some former idle hours, for which I'd fain reward thee. I am not ungrateful, and will protect thee, Marian, but beware thou raise no rock to make more difficult the upward path I climb. Dost comprehend my words plainer now?
Quite plain. They find my heart out straight. Alas! Too well I know that our affections to our conscience oft do play the traitors. Love me then no more. I seek but justice. Armed with honesty, we may defy the stings of outward ill, yea, laugh to scorn the malice of the world and teach it envy. Load the heart with guilt, and the calm look of an unconscious babe can set the cheek on fire. Make me not pray for death to save me from my own child's eye. Methinks I see him bend his blushing brow upon my grave, and hear him cry, O mother, hadst thou no heritage but shame to leave thy wretched offspring?
Cling not to me thus. I like it not. Marian, I bid you rise. Fond girl, thou shouldst have known my nature more than to believe my purpose might be swayed by such a whining homily as this.
Marian, springing up wildly.
Another voice, another look than mine must force a passage to this stony heart yet newly closed. Come, little advocate.
She takes the child.
Fail thou, we're lost indeed. Hush, darling, hush, 'tis nothing. Look upon this cherub face, the blue eye glistening through the half-formed tear, the tiny fingers in each other twined, as some sweet angel prompted him to join his wretched mother's prayer. Canst thou refuse so innocent a pleader? Take us hence. Leave us in scorn, disgrace, and poverty, but, oh, not here!
Away! I cannot! Hence! Thou wilt not!
Marian, clasping him.
Never! Never!
Laurenti cast her off violently.
Fool! Then thus I cast thee from me. Since thou wilt not take the offered good, bear with thy slavish lot, menial attendant at a felon's board. Or get more colour in thy wasted cheek, and comb thy white locks sleekly. Someone yet may take compassion on those waning charms, and give them shelter. If this suit thee not, starve if thou wilt, and die!
Exit.
My poor, poor child. Is this the end? There. To thy rest again, my bird. O dull, unwilling heart, to see the cause of this rejection. He has looked upon a nobler head, a fairer face, a merrier heart than this grief-stricken one. Ha! He hath roused a feeling in my soul I knew not slept there. Rest, my gentle child. 'Tis well thou canst not judge thy mother's thought that leans above. We will be both avenged.
Scene closes. Scene 3, in a house near Winchester. Edith, Ethelind.
Your journey, madam, suited not the will of Master Laurency.
The eager zeal with which he did oppose it gave more strength to my resolve. Clothed with some secret power, he sways our destiny, and 'tis no shame to say I fear him. Yet I would not stay. Ha! Here at last! Leave us, good Ethelind.
Enter Laurency attended. Exit Ethelind.
What news of Dudley? Hast thou seen him? Hath he sent for me? Speak, Laurency, and say how fares my lord.
Laurency to attendant.
Some wine. My throat is parched.
One word, I pray you.
Let me ne'er bestride yon dapple moor. She flung at every bush, as if a lion couched there. I would know when Master Vivian comes.
Exeunt attendants.
Oh, wilt not answer?
Ha, lady, what's with me?
With thee, alas, very, very much. I'd have thee render back a perilled life. I'd have thee to uncoil a clinging viper from thy heart, whose sting hath else eternal power. I'd have thee wash from thy stained soul the wrong that thou hast done in making merchandise of the dear blood of thy familial friend.
I marvel what the suit may be to which these kindly taunts are but the prelude.
Pardon me. Grief doth not pause amidst its wild career to measure courteous phrase. Forgive this fault, if such thou deem it. What thou hast done ill, thou canst undo. Give me my lord again.
Laurency, after a pause.
Our lady, are these clasped and suppliant hands the same that waved me from thy presence once with such royal scorn? Are these the eyes all humid with bright and harmless showers that scathed me with their lightning? This the voice that, when I murmured of my passionate love, desired me to take my palfrey and depart, and I should have thy gratitude? Nay, come, I fear me 'tis but mockery. Alack, I know and do mistrust the baleful smile that wreathes the tyrant's lip when his low mien doth mock the victim with humility, thus guiding torture's sting.
Is this an hour, a theme for jesting? Can a passing breath of hasty spleen demand such reckoning? Oh, take a nobler vengeance! Laurency, thy mind is changed, not nature. Hear me, grant my prayer.
I will.
Ah, then I did thee wrong, deeming that conflict with the world had torn the rich acquired virtue from thy heart, leaving the sterner dross of selfishness, our nature's earliest born. Oh, thou shalt win a gift no gold may purchase, that sweet peace that self-approval brings.
Come, this is well. No thanks, I do my portion, richly paid by this most blissful moment. Thus we seal our mutual compact. Now thou art mine indeed.
Advancing as if to embrace her, she starts back.
It cannot be. Thou dost not mean it. Say thou dost not mean it. Listen, Laurency, thou standst this moment where the paths divide to good and evil. Choose the right, nor make the devils blush at thine excelling sin. I tell thee, could I list such fearful terms, the sacrifice were vain, for he would cast, in hate and scorn, the worthless life away, bought at such price.
Well, be it as you will. I have been bred in disappointment's school, and will endure. 'Twill be a sore sight when some dark locks we wot of are beheld wreathing the hangman's fingers, when low hinds, while homeward wending from their honest toil, gaze on the blackening features and cry, "See the bloody traitor's doom!" While mothers raise their whimpering brats to touch the scaffold's rim and bid them love their king.
Oh, God, no more!
And yet thou lovest him. Ha! Flimsy thread is woman's love, a toy, a summer thing, of flowers and sunshine, and the poet's dream. Lo, how the winter of self-sacrifice doth chill it to the core.
my life for his. 'Twas for my sake, and at my will he joined the traitor's company. Accuse me, then.
Thee, my sweet friend? Methinks our gallant king may well forgive so fair a foe all harm her power might work him. Patience, gentlewoman. Remember, thou thyself art here arraigned for a great crime, thy cruelty to one who loved thee. Ah, how well!
Good Laurency, taunt me no more. If thou art human, cease this devilish mockery. Love I cannot give. It dwells within a cold and dreary cell, bound to the fettered prisoner with a tie stronger than all his chains. What hate so fell could plant a scorpion on his couch of stone, or quench the last lone spark that cheers the night of his soul's darkness? Take my gold, I pray thee, my land, my jewels. I will be thy slave, thy mistress never.
I have slaves already, or what makes them so. I want thy love, thee and thy love. Look you, I jest no more. Be mine thou shalt. Ay, sweetheart, never dream that thine accursed minion can escape my vengeance. Know that, though the headsman miss, my hatred shall be fed.
Dost thirst for blood? Oh, seek no further for the sacrifice. My bosom woos thy dagger. This black sin I will not do.
Then thou hast murdered him, and henceforth upon thy stubborn head lie this young traitor's blood.
Going, returns.
If 1 hour hence thou dost relent.
Away! I heed thee not. I know not what thou speakest. Go. Thy words make a strange, senseless murmur in mine ear. My soul rejects their meaning. Tempter, hence!
Exit Laurency. Edith remains motionless, absorbed in grief, till Vivian enters.
Madam, my master, that is, I would say, my friend, desired me to bring this loving scroll to your fair hand. 'Tis from your lord.
Edith snatches it eagerly.
And say that, but you chid him hence, he would have told much that had given you comfort. What calm cheer marked the discourse?
Not see me? Do I read the words all right? Bid me return and leave my husband fence with foes. Have I not sworn to cheer and tend him through all grief and pain, even as we shared our love? And now depart, nor through the windows of his dungeon bend one parting look on him? Alas, what hour so much demands the duty he disdains? Speak, sir, I cannot read this riddle. Speak, canst thou?
If my poor judgment may presume, he knows his safety best. Doth he not write of love, of pardon, duty, sacrifice? Nay, says he not his life's salvation rests on thy most prompt obedience?
Aye, 'tis so, even so 'tis written. Heaven my footsteps guide, as he can scarce test that obedience more. I am ready at your pleasure.
Exit. Re-enter Laurency.
Bravely done, shrewd second. Let not this consenting mood change by delay. Tomorrow we'll set forth for those broad lands which, fairly confiscate, shall call me lord. For our caged bird, all safe. We are not like to hear his note again. Hugh Kinsell is his keeper. What's thou more?
Exeunt. Scene 4. The Prison. Latimer, as if suddenly awakening.
Let go my arms. Why do ye mock me? Ha, false villain, I can reach thee still. 'Tis naught. Thank God I slept. Boy, that silly dream should make me breathless as with desperate strife and fill my brain with horror. Laurency, when next we meet, this hot cheek shall betray the wrong my dreams have done thee. I thought, while sadly musing o'er my numbered hours, a silent angel came and set me free and pointed to my home. There Edith stood to greet her lord, when one like Laurency leaped from the earth beneath my very feet and bore her shrieking thence. 'Twas terrible. Still I behold that look of malice mixed with fiercer passion. Hark, the bolt revolves.
Enter Marion, stealthily.
my mute purveyor. I ne'er held thy step as I do now. Speak to me.
I am changed since you beheld me.
So thou art, indeed. Or else this dungeon light gives ghastlier hue than captive cheeks are wont to wear.
I mean, my heart is changed.
Gentler it cannot be, and that thou art not grown less merciful, this visit proves.
I bring nor hope nor aid. Hope mocks me ever. Pity veils her brow. The flowers I plant bear thorns. Why should I deal in mercy's sweet and tender offices, yet ne'er partake of them?
Because thou art, stern as thou seem'st, and wronged as thou mayst be, with every bright and cherished hope o'erthrown, a woman still.
Marion, aside.
Now, wherefore parley thus? Sir, do you love your life? Nay, answer me, and on the instant.
I am young to meet the grisly monster, open-armed, without one backward glance upon the sunny fields that promised such fair harvest. And besides, I would not that our trysting place should be the traitor's scaffold.
Thou wouldst then be free.
E'en so, fair witch.
It is ill jesting now with death and torture round you. Know then, sir, I come to traffic with thee for thy life. My price, revenge. This is a market world, and we its merchants, buyers and sellers all. Health, peace, and life for pride of place and rule. Honor for love, and happiness for gold. But all these, for vengeance. I am wronged, and being a woman, friendless, weak, and frail, I need the service of a stalwart arm like thine. Do but my bidding, and thou art free. Refuse, and here I leave thee to thy doom. Slow, dim despair, and jailer bribed to slay. Come, choose. But 3 days past I would have spent my heart's blood, drop by drop, to save from harm one hair of that fair brow. I'll not look back. Love lies behind. Hate onward. Wouldst thou live? But now my thought grows wild, my senses reel. Blood! I will have his blood.
Can passion work a change so fearful? Thou hast not yet named him who hath wronged thee.
Laurency.
My friend, leave thy revenge to God. I will not stain this hand with kindred blood on such vague cause as thy wild words have shown. What hath he done?
No more. Back to thy fetters and thy straw. Thy fearless look misled me. I mistook thy nature. I will work my own revenge. Hear thou the sentence which was read to me. Starve, if thou wilt, and die.
She retires.
Oh, Edith, Edith!
Marion returns suddenly.
Stay. I will leave thee tidings that will serve to quicken the dull thought that prison bars are apt to nourish. Thy fair Edith lies within the peril of a ruffian snare. 'Tis closing round her.
Huh, my dream again, yet now I slumber not. Stay, tell me more. Torturer, wilt thou leave me?
Think on that. There's food for much conjecture, is there not?
Hold, in pity. Is this dungeon hell? And yon fair thing a demon sent to prove my spirit's power? I will follow thee. Girl, thou hast raised a fiend, with which to dwell alone exceeds my power. What of my wife, my Edith? Hath she? Woman, thou didst speak of danger, of a snare. Fool, 'tis plain. It is my dream's reality.
Wilt thou revenge me? Swear.
I swear.
Marion unlocks the chain.
'Tis well.
Brings a disguise.
Throw these rude garments o'er you. Quickly now. Follow with boldness. What dost hear? No word.
Excellent. Scene 5. A street near the castle. Enter Latimer and Marion.
Now thou art free. Away. And quickly make thy ransom good.
Latimer detains her.
Quit me not yet, strange guide. We do not part so soon.
Remove thy hand, or by my soul, and that this moment seems the fearfulest thing I know. I'll straight denounce thy noted name. Go, sir.
Stops as she retires.
Avoid the tower, for man today makes holiday to see his fellow butchered. Fare you well.
Exit Marion.
The tower? What secret impulse bids me seek the spot from which she warns me? I will go. Good rags, be my protection.
As he is going, enter a group of citizens.
Master, if thou hast no vast affection for a broken crown, take my advice. Stop here.
I pray you, sir, what do they at the tower?
What do they at the tower? Curtailed man's fair proportions, sir. Would see the subjects they do practice on stand here by me. The pikemen forced us back from round the scaffold, but they pass this way.
Enter more citizens, with country people of both sexes.
Good morrow, Peter.
Thank ye, sir. Canst make room for this lady? She's my sweetheart, Maud.
Surely. 'Twere pity, but all dames should see what frolics toward here. Oh, woman, woman, why doth thy prying imp of curious heart make ye but tigers? Were a man impaled or flayed alive, ye don your ribboned gear, bid all your friends about you, and close up the day with mirth. Woman, kind woman, pah! The devil might take your kindness at a gulp, and never choke himself.
Blockhead! Dost hear this parrot rail upon our tender sex, and durst not answer him?
Art rude to Maud? I'll lay this cudgel cross thy saucy pate. Will hold thy prowl?
Oh, content thee, man. Till Maud's thy wife, best keep thy crab stick whole, else I'm no judge of feature.
Give's thy hand. What? There's no need to quarrel. Only mark, I'd have thee neighbourly.
See, here are two.
Enter the Lords Cobham and Grey, guarded, and pass over.
Of the condemned, Lord Cobham and Lord Grey, methinks, my noble lords, it was not here ye thought to share your honours. See how slow and mumbling the traitors walk. Aha! Brave for the king, my masters.
Who comes here? Wands! But he bears him cheerily.
'Tis Markham, he who was page at court, the silken traitor. Look how he singles out each pretty face, with laugh and leer. His hair and garb as trim as he would seek his lady's bower, not join the headsman levy.
He's a proper man. Would he were uglier. Must that fair brow?
Enter Sir Griffin Markham, guarded.
Stoop to the block? I vow I'll speak to him.
Presses forward and curtsies.
God bless your worship.
Thanks, my pretty one. No kinder greeting has been mine today, ere this, than knave and traitor. I'll no tongue save thine to sing mine obsequies. Farewell. Forward, sirs, forward.
Enter an officer, hastily.
Hold, pause here a while. The culprits would confess. You'll pardon, sir, this brief detention.
Sir, I've borne my life some 30 years, and will endure its weight some 30 minutes more, were't but to show my duty to the king.
Advances a little to the crowd.
In this fair mass of honest faces, is there one which shows so much of sympathy as will not shrink from kindly office for a man condemned?
All retire but Latimer.
But one, and he a beggar? Loyal hearts, is treason so contagious? Hither, friend, stout honesty oft hides in mean attire. There's promise in thy rags.
Coming closer to Latimer.
'Tis said, my friend, our senses quicken as their end draws near. Prithee, look unconcerned. Thou art Latimer, and never trust me. But it glads my heart to see thy limbs uncumbered by these toys, and free to do my message. There is one. Behold her image, Dudley.
Shows a portrait.
I had thought to wear it on my breast till the sweet touch were felt no longer. See her, Dudley. Say I loved. No more. Yes, Tell her, if she hears, I showed a light step and a careless mien unto the crowd. It was no part of me. My spirit's eye shone on a far green veil. My last prayer for her peace was winged for heaven. My heart was full of her.
Poor Genevieve.
Hist, they may note you. These are hanging tears. Nay, Latimer, why ruffle with that name my soldier bearing?
Enter another officer.
All is ready now. The heads are fallen, the scaffold cleared. Lead on to execution.
Hark, the prompter calls. Methinks it were scarce mannerly to keep mine audience waiting. Now their tragic thirst is newly whetted. Latimer, farewell. Commend me in all honourable love to your fair bride. Ne'er yet in woman's shape showed virtue lovelier. I'd fain behold your meeting. Get you from this dangerous place.
Aloud to Latimer as he retires.
Farewell, Sir Clod. I know thou'lt not forget my mission. Farewell thou, my dark-eyed friend. On, sirs, ye chafe me with this funeral pace. A little faster.
Exeunt all but Latimer, the crowd pressing after.
Noble heart, farewell. How much my thought hath wronged thee. Was it shame of thine own warmth and honour veiled thee thus in mean fantastic? I'll not see thee die.
Exit. And enter at the other side, Hugh Kensel and others, armed with a citizen.
By yonder corner. Ha! Mine eye just caught the flutter of his ragged cloak. He makes straight for the river.
20 crowns I give the man who grasps him first. Jerome and Cole, round to yon corner and head back the game. We follow on his track. Who's for the crowns?
That's right. Your staves, sirs. We are sure of him.
Exeunt, running different ways. End of Act 3.
This audiobook is brought to you by Full Audiobooks. Please like, subscribe, and click the bell icon if you love audiobooks.
Act 4 of The Lords of Ellingham by Henry Spicer. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Act 4, Scene 1. The Garden at Ellingham. Edith, Ethelind.
Look at your dial, Ethelind. The day is surely waning.
'Tis just noon.
No more. Alas, fair sun, what blessed thing hast found? What charm in this wild labyrinth of woe, that thou dost linger thus to gaze on it, deeming the pause repaid? Would our weak eyes might reach so far.
Dear madam, gaze not thus into the bosom of these sultry heavens with an unsheltered brow. Let me but throw this veil around you.
Wrap me my shroud. Grief's veil. Is that not best, my Ethelind? A mantle welcome to the day-tired eye, drooping and fainting for its rest. A robe fairer of fashion, yea, more coveted than pricely vestments. For it wraps a slave from bondage freed, no more the sport of sin, ambition's thirst, nor passion's haunted dream, nor grief, nor dread. Come here and sit by me. Did I not talk of dreams? I'll tell thee what befell last night.
What was it, dear lady?
Hark! Put close thine ear. Are we secure? Methinks the air is listening, it has grown so still. The flowers seem glancing hitherward. Come on, into this nook. Their bright eyes pain me. Hist! 'Twas thus. There sat a weight upon my bosom, a crouching phantom whose white ghastly hand beckoned my sleep away. There was a sound of fluttering wings, as if a prisoned bird had seen her lovemate in the skies at play and would be with him. Then the lattice seemed to open, and I heard his voice, the voice of Latimer. Alas!
Dear lady, what said he in thy dream?
Aye, 'Twas a dream. My senses all partook. I saw him too, felt, for he bent him o'er me as I lay, and then his long hair touched me, and 'twas cold and dank with dew. Oh, bitter was the tone that then addressed me. Die, my Edith, die! Lo, sweet oblivion hath prepared the cup. Dost thou not thirst like me? There are more worlds than this most false one. We shall meet again. I know that we shall meet again. And where? I spoke in whispers. Answer there was none. But on the casement beat the large fierce rain, and with a crash it closed.
You wakened then. The Blessed Virgin shield us from all ill. Would we might never dream.
So thou wouldst cast a world away, leaving that soul most poor that doth possesses no other. Gentle sleep, who paints forgotten pictures on our hearts so that we deem them real, gives despair hope's wealthful whisper, brings the beggar wealth, plucks down oppression, bursts the prison door, and justice gives unbribed. Nay, let us dream, for only then, if we perforce must err, 'tis done in innocence. Whose form is that amid the trees? Methought that here mine eyes might shun the presence of false scheming men. But there's no peace, no peace.
I know his gait. 'Tis Walter Vivian. Look, he turns away, now stops, now turns again. How chafed he seems. Thou wouldst avoid him, lady?
He is one I dread to look upon. I pray thee, come this way.
In yonder bower we shall be safe from his rude scrutiny. Retire, sweet madam. I have a charm to lure this dragon hence. Trust him to me.
As they go out, Vivian enters.
He grows in malice, too, e'en as in villainy. Fretful spite that show in every action. Blind and sottish fool to yoke my fortune to so wild a car, which bears me breathless over rugged ways and depths scarce fathomed, from whose fearful leap my cooler thought recoils. And for what end have I done this? For none. Offence, nor feud had I with Latimer, no revenge to wreak in blood and ruin. I was poor before, so am I still. By heaven, I'll move no more in aid of Laurency. As yet...
Enter Ethelyn.
How now? What sturdy vagrant's this, that dare approach so near my mistress's person? Out, alack, to his Master Vivian. Pardon, gentle sir, I took you for a rogue, some petty thief, some jailbird, newly freed. But now I see how much I did mistake.
Curtsying ironically.
Well said, my lass. No music soothes me like a woman's tongue tuned for a scold. I am in a bitter mood, and would be cheered. So here I'll rest me. Now go on. Thou hast a spirit. In good faith thou hast a spirit.
Would that men might say the like of thee. Thou wear'st a sword, indeed. Is't of true metal, or of a peacock's plume? And hast a manly swagger, airs would fright my very grandame. Still, I dare be sworn, the worth o' the picture's chiefly in the frame.
Again, well spoken. Rosier lips than thine, and now I mark thee close, a slenderer form, yea, smaller feet. Mine eyesight hath not scanned this many a day. I'd almost kiss thee, girl. But for a vow I made, when sorely hurt in a vain quarrel, ne'er to give again my heart a prey to the sweet devilry of that fair mischief woman.
To that vow my lips and thine own ears are much beholden. May a poor damsel know what mighty cause hath moved this generous ire. At shovel-board did master hold fast to beat thee? Or perchance was the last flask of Malvoisie too sour to please thy cunning palate?
Worse than that. What think you? The new lord took strange offence at some misdoing, struck the steward twice, a grey old man that might have been his sire, and hath discharged the cellarer, a man whom with crossed hands I had vowed friendship to.
A most discreet old man.
A worthy man, and a most jovial comrade. Nay, 'tis base. but my pouch is empty as a drum, I'd serve his beck no longer.
Art thou mad to tell me so? What, if yon busy bird, affecting but to plume her painted wings, close at thine ear, were gathering up a tale to muse thy master, thou'dst be packing soon. Ay, sir, right quickly, thou'dst be fain to take thine honored spy-ship hence.
My master, truly, since when I wore his livery? Hark you, girl, his neck's no safer than another man's. Were it my will to... I'll talk no more.
Tis best. Thou'dst else betray some confidence, that none but knaves should hear, some thievish craft, some scheme that, like a slimy reptile, crawls to sting in darkness, some most valorous plot against a woman, when no manly foot is near to crush ye. But these heavens that shine, one stained with deeds like this had better dwell on savage shores, with things untaught and wild, than strut the world, clad in such garb as thine, and call himself a man.
It was not I. No deed of mine. I thought...
Aside. Turns away.
Am I a fool? To blush and stammer like a chidden child before this wench's eye. 'Tis bitter truth gives her words venom. She but drives more deep a thorn was fixed before. This shall not be. New thoughts arise within. I'm not yet so much at odds with virtue as to make all reconcilement vain. I'll speak to her. Tell her the tidings. Ask her. Ethelind!
Go. I am sad. I'd weep, but for a heartless ruffler standing by, to laugh and mock at me.
I'd mock thee not. Nay, Ethelind, dear girl, believe me now. Less hardened than I seem, I here reject an office fits me not. I honor thee, and pity thy poor mistress.
'Tis too late. Alas, alas, too late.
For once thou art wrong. Canst keep a secret safely? Spare thy fib, for I will trust thee, woman as thou art, having some slight discretion. I have heard, no matter how, but I believe the tale, that by a hand which fought in former days by old Sir Gerald's side, some instruments, useful for man's enlargement, were conveyed to an imprisoned knight, one Latimer, who thereupon escaped, and left behind some fragments of black bread, an empty chain, and a kind caution to his careful wards to make their captives sure.
Is this true?
'Twas thought he sailed for Flanders, but of this I have no certain knowledge. To thy mistress, and with these news possessed, sing in her ear a song of comfort. Say withal that I, Walter Vivian, kiss her hands in shame, that I have stained my erewhile manhood, just joining her crafty foe, but from henceforth am vowed her champion.
Never would I seek a blither errand. Tell me, ere I go, wherefore this sudden but most welcome change?
A brain-sick fancy, chiefly of mine own, and something more. I see thou dost not know my history. I was an only child, an only petted child, and slew my mother. Nay, start not, girl. My folly and my guilt, that brought disgrace upon an honored name, gave heaven its sweetest saint. I broke her heart, and then I loved her.
When she knew it not.
She saw, and knew it. Say why else, I pray you, when any dark or evil destiny o'erhangs my path, doth her sweet presence shine in warning round me? Not in anger, no, but with a mother's smile, and such low hymns as I the dim remembrance to have heard sung over my cradle. Thrice I have seen her thus, and thrice some ill hath followed. When last night, but tis nothing. To thy charge, my maid.
Exeunt severally. Scene 2, a hall. Grossfeldt, Wilhelm, Marjorie.
And so thou knewst not that my lady kept a goblin for her page?
Loath should I be to think that any dame of gentle birth could so indulge her fancy. But thy sex was ever doting.
He hath seldom deigned to grace us with his presence since the day that Wilhelm strove with him. 'Twas boldly done to cope with one of Satan's brood. But what provoked the imp? Didst imitate his gait, or note his hunchback?
No,
I did but say the Lady Edith, having lost her lord, might well do worse than be our master's bride, or friend as paramours, when, as I live, the crooked malignant darted at my throat, and, though I robbed the hornet of his sting, it is.
Shows a dagger.
And saved my life, I promise you, his clutch left marks upon me, sore and black.
Enter Ethelyn.
As from the devil's claw.
Good Marjorie, as I passed through the banquet hall, I saw a rent across the tapestry that might well admit thee with thy Sunday farthingale, nor set one plait awry.
The Virgin save us!
Hurries out.
Is not thy lord returned?
He'll scarce be here within 2 hours. A youth whose horse fell lame at Palmer's Ford tells that the chase took head due south, and when he quitted was at least 3 leagues from hence.
Thy lord will tire, and then ye know his worship's humour. You'd not share the steward's fate. See that he finds no peg whereon to hang his anger, but prepare to give him soft reception.
In good time. I'd talk with thee a little.
Approaches mincingly.
Go, Sir Fool, attend thy business.
Exeunt Grossfeldt and Wilhelm.
In 2 hours, 'tis well. May briars choke his path, and snake-weed bind each foot his horse puts homeward. Can I keep these gossips safe, and Vivian hold his brains unclouded by the purple witchery of his besetting fiend? When to his snares yon nimble hunter comes, he'll find that, while he urged the chase afar, his fairer prey hath broke her covert, and is stolen away.
Exit. Scene 3. A part of the grounds as in Act 2. Enter Lorenzi with huntsman, etc.
Hang yon spotted bitch without delay. Beauty, ye call her? Hang her! 'Tis the wont of beauties to mislead the pack. Beside, her throat is out of tune. Dost hear me, sirrah? Now what dost gape at?
Did your honour say the spotted one, the best your kennel shows? So Master Dudley said.
She shall be hanged. Rather that thou bring'st a name that's rent from loyal bosoms like a worthless weed to thwart my mood.
But, sir, the hound is staunch.
Dost parley with me, fellow? Here, give up thy belt and horn. Seek out another lord. Take thyself hence.
Enter Vivian.
And what dost thou? Here still? Did I not bid thee ride to Salisbury ere supper time? Beshrew thee, what dost here?
A quiet saunter under these cool trees did better suit my fancy. I'll not ride tonight. No, nor tomorrow, nor next day, unless the humour serve.
Why, what means this?
To attendants.
Away, sirs. Now, thou most untoward knave, where are the papers my rash confidence gave to thy drunken charge? Dispersed, I trow, that every boor the village parson's skill hath taught his letters may grow wise upon the secrets of our state.
The scrolls are safe, heed not for that. But I'll no longer be an unrewarded drudge to bear the scorn which shames thy former smooth-lipped courtesy. 'Twas then good Walter, and my trusty friend, lend me thine aid. The game is played, and I, the while thou fattening on the treasure won, in purse and prospect, am as lean as ever. I'll have 1,000 crowns. Thou canst spare these, nor injure much thy rent-roll.
Greedy rogue! Here, take this purse, and see thou get'st no drink more than thou hast already.
If I drink, 'tis but to drown the devil. He is here, here at my elbow, at my cup, at my bed, with his cold hissing whisper, calling me a pander to the guilty purposes of yet a greater villain than myself. Yet that, methinks, is much.
There, get thee gone.
Be gone? With 20 bits of yellow dirt for so much honest service? Fie, thou payest thy ploughman better. What, grown miserly?
Tempt not my patience further. Friend, beware. let us not quarrel. I am hot as thou, and, being provoked, more dangerous. I say, beware!
Beware thyself! Why, who art thou? My father was an honest gentleman. Can't stay as much for thine.
Go! Go! Thou art drunk! Not worth a weapon which would else chastise this swaggering insolence.
He mouths it well, this manly weaver of destructive wiles, against boys and women. Yon poor helpless girl is not thy victim. Chaste she is, and fair. And thou, I'll not say what I think of thee now, but she is safe. I will protect her. Ay, storm as thou wilt, and vapor with thy sword, that bird hath scaped the snare.
Lorenzi draws and advances on him.
Stand from my path, or I will dash thee to the earth. Give back! What? Wilt thou tempt thy fate?
I fear thee not. Come on.
They fight. And Vivian falls.
A curse of English hearts upon thy French-taught tricks of fence. Thou hadst me there. Thy bodkin's point has pricked me from the world. Ere I can make my peace with honesty. Right, gossip, who didst once pronounce broad blade no match for 4-foot rapier. It were well I'd remembered thee. Look, Lawrence, and mark heaven's justice. On this very spot I sold myself to thee. As thou art a man, retrace with speed thy steps of damning guilt. For if thou dost not, know that even now there is a bloodhound baying on thy track. Will quit thee not until his tooth be fleshed upon thine inmost heart. Oh me, I faint. What dancing forms are here? Sir, stop this blood. Laughst thou, assassin, at thy goodly work? Oh, Lady Edith, ill for thee, I fear.
He faints.
Beshrew thee for a quarrel-seeking knave. Thou forcest thy blood upon me. Well, with thee, if I mistake not, lie some secrets which in earth's kind bosom may more soundly sleep than on thy slippery tongue. The whelp I reared grew to a lion with his teeth undrawn, and might at will have turned those dangerous fangs upon his feeder. So, thy work is done. I will go bind my arm, as injured by some sudden onslaught, then return to see this clay disposed. So much, old friend, for thee.
Exit. Enter Edith in humble garments.
Alas, my shadow warns me that the day is older than I thought. The heavens dispose a patient spirit sways my champion's breast. Soft, here he lies. Great God, to slumber thus at such a moment! Hist! Good friend, awake! 'Twas not my will to keep thee. Why dost sleep so sound when... Wake, I say! Time passes, wake! We must go hence! Fie, lazy sentinel, is this thy watchful faith? Up, up for pity! Great heaven, what stain is on my robe? 'Tis red, 'tis blood, the sleeper's blood, and he will wake no more till angels summon. Hold, he moves, may yet be.
Vivian, reviving.
Water, water, friends, I thirst. Goes the day with us? Ha, a woman here? This is no battlefield. My wandering brain takes up its broken theme. My life is sped. And by his hand for whom I blindly toiled, my soul's mortal hurt. Night comes apace. Fly, madam, fly. I had the will to save, and now the power has left me. Pray you, fly.
Care not for that. You are not hurt to death. I will call aid.
Sweet lady, spare thy pains. The steel has done its fatal office well, and drank at my heart's fountain. I could feel the branching rivulets of that great source stop shuddering in their way. I'll speak to thee. Stoop, kneel beside me. my husband.
Starting up.
God, who sings so sweetly in mine ear? That voice, I know it well. 'Tis his music. Heavenly sounds, unheard since boyhood's days. Familiar then, come floating round.
Sinks back.
Mine eyes are dull with sleep. Alas, poor mother, art thou with me still? Thy mad boy comes at last. Lady, farewell. Stay not to see me die, but hasten. Ah, my mother.
He dies.
He's dead, and was my friend. Poor blinded instrument, whose services were bought by promise and repaid with blood. Thy fate transcends my own. Oh, where to fly? In the wide world there is no goal nor guide, since death hath locked the lips that should have told of Dudley's refuge. Ah!
Re-enter Lorenzi, his arm in a scarf.
My truant bird, wouldst slip thy jesses? Grows thy perch so dull that thou wouldst fain expand those pretty wings and try a bolder venture?
Hast thou torn life's temple down, and now returns't to mock its senseless ruins? Scorner, jest no more, lest this pale witness quit his bloody bed, and bid the slow avenger speed.
Nay, nay, I would have spared thy gentle eye, my love, this most unsightly scene. But as you see, had need myself of aid.
He draws the body under the trees.
Thou'rt pale, my rose. And these rude robes befit thee not, albeit thy beauty shows more nobly from their foil. Let us go in.
Heaven wills not such dark deeds should go unpunished. Latimer is safe, and, be thou sure, will well reward the pains thou hast bestowed for him. These cheering news thy murdered comrade brought me.
Then he died with a vile falsehood on his lips. 'Tis true, Dudley escaped. But how, I know not. None, save grim old Hugo, and yon wilful girl, had access to his cell, and that, I trow, was deep enough, for I, his chamberlain, selected it. But there were hawks abroad, and the freed pigeon circled round so oft, ere darting homeward, that his flight was stayed. You'll scarce try that again. Now list to me, fair dame. For all thy lofty crested pride, womanly craft, and wilful stubbornness, have I not conquered? What? Is true?
'Tis true. Alas, what wouldst thou more?
The labour done, comes the reward. Wouldst thou deny the fruit of all my long and careful husbandry? Tut! I've but catered for the royal feast which I shall now enjoy, and only pause to note its daintiness. Come hither, sweet. Nay, fear me not. I do not love thee now. Vengeance has long usurped the vacant throne, but reigns as a fierce tyrant. Come, sit down.
Leads her to a seat.
And I will tell thee of a thing I saw when absent last. Watson, thou know'st, is dead.
Dead?
On the scaffold. So is Clark. These both less guilty than thy lord. I stood by them in the last moments of their awful doom. They were dragged forth.
Bear me the tale.
And hanged. But not to death. Oh, that were merciful to what succeeded. With clenched hands, with throats black with a stifling rope, and breath that came in short, convulsive throbs, they chained them down. Already pale, 'tis well thou couldst not hear the last loud shriek of mortal anguish, wrung from those whose superhuman fortitude struck all that gazed with awe. Men hear it yet, but oh, the savage yell that round me rose, when the masked torturer, with his bloody hands, tore from their wretched bosoms life's quick source, that dogs might fight for it. In sooth, I wept to think that fearful scene was but the first of a most dismal pageant. Who comes next? List to the thrilling whisper of thy heart. It needs no word of mine.
Edith starts up with sudden wildness.
Speak! Speak! Can save him?
Aye. So thy part be done.
Edith, after a pause of intense agitation.
Tis o'er. I yield. Do what thou wilt. Come, devil as thou art, struggle no longer for thy hellish hire. Body and soul destroy me. Work thy will. In all the outward fashion of a man, thou dost confront me, and I hear thy voice fearfully tempting. Look! There is God's throne, whereto the stain of murder doth attain, ere earth can green it o'er. God's blessed air surrounds us, and is passing onward now, soiled with thy words of sin and treachery, yet harmless all to thee. From this I know that heaven forsakes me. No, he shall not die. I will not leave that form of honoured life to the cold gaze of scoffing multitudes. I will not give the generous heart a prey for human wolves to tear. What price too dear that makes him free? Take life, hope, honour, all, but save him, save him!
She falls senseless at his feet.
Hard won victory, most lovely prize. Mine! My pulses bound exultingly, and through each vein the blood runs with a merry leap. Mine at last! Oh, for an echo to repeat that sound, till, like a flatterer, it hath cloyed mine ear. I must be cool a while. Fair little hand, that liest so calmly in the grasp of mine, as 'twere thy natural home, let me become emboldened to thy touch. By your leave, lady.
He bears her toward the house.
For we must woo these fleeting roses back to grace our revel. Ho! Within!
Attendants enter.
Good girls, support your mistress tenderly. The day has been too sultry for this delicate flower. A little sleep restores her. Rest then, love. Rest, and ere night, be thy fair self again.
Exeunt. Scene 4. A dark and stormy night, without the great hall, the windows of which appear brightly illuminated. Sounds of feasting within. A figure, at the side, is crouched beneath a tree. Enter from the house, Ethelind, Grosvelt following.
Nay, thou shalt not chide me back. I'd go, were it twice as far, in twice so dark a night, to bear thee company. Come, give us a kiss. Thou wilt not? 'Tis not every man would quit a jolly meal and fire for sake of one discharged from service.
Back, friend, to thy lord. Tell him he sent me forth in poverty, and thinly clad for storms. Yet I've a gem that all his hoards of ill-won wealth could buy, an honest heart. Let the chill winds rail on. Heaven still provides a cloak for innocence, warmer than miniver. I'd rather herd with savage beasts than have no sense of guile, than men of deadly malice like your lord, and ye the coward creatures of his will.
What, I a coward? I dare but to speak that word again, and—
The figure rises and comes forward.
What's this? Oh, Lord! Quick, sirs, I'm murdered! I—
Runs frightened into the house.
Gargantua!
Aye, why art thou here? Why dost thou quit the house in such a night and hour?
Fiends rule within. He hath prevailed. Oh, my loved mistress, thou art lost indeed. With eyes o'erwatched, o'erwept, heart torn with struggling passions, hope and fear, even to the verge of reason, she hath fallen before his dread temptations. And, is now. Alas, alas, ask me no further.
Weeps.
Hark, what sounds are those within?
Tis there he feasts.
Gargantua climbs to a window near the buttress and looks in.
Those whom the rumors of his wealth or dread of his strange secret influence have made his creatures. Is the fierce light paints thy cheek so scarlet? No, against his ghastly pale. Speak, why dost thou glare with that unearthly eye, bending the iron stanchions with thy hand, like wands of hazel? Speak!
Gargantua, muttering.
A dream no more.
Speak! What dost see, Gargantua? What dost see? Speak, ere I climb beside thee.
Woman, hold. Now I can speak. I have my voice again. Prepare thine ears to list a tale of hell, which I will read thee from this fearful book, line upon line. A banquet board is spread, rich fruit and luscious wines that lure men's brain to the most delightful madness. There are met the boisterous bully and the rough-tongued squire, glib sycophants and cringing slaves that lack the courage to be villains too. But tamed and fangless serpents, kept innocuous by some master villain's hand. There is one woman there, in crimson robes and gold. Mine eyes devour her beauty, yet can scarce endure its fierceness. Her cheek's fever seems to scorch the white plumes drooping from her brow. Her eyes flash fearful luster. She looks up. Oh God, mine own are seared.
Ethelind, impatiently.
Again, again, seest thou not further?
Lilies in the midst are shining. Oh, 'tis sweet to gaze upon them. Pearls of the garden, children chaste and fair, midst the red splendour of that guilty scene, ye only speak of heaven.
Whom seest thou?
One who, like the chief of rebel angels, sits ruling them to his will. They move. Alas, a sickness seizes me. I would to God 'twere done.
Enough, come down.
By heavens, I will not. I'll even see out the play. Be patient yet, there's more to come. There's more. They bring a harp. 'Tis that which Dudley gave. Oh, Ethelind, what feeling bids them tax that swelling heart to make them music? Look, she puts it by. Now rises the tormentor. With soft step, he steals behind her chair. He whispers words of soothing mockery. He makes strange signs. He quells her with his fiendish eye. Ah, now she takes the harp again. Man, 'tis in vain. She cannot do thy will. With livid cheek she turns to him, and murmurs words which call the colour to his brow. He lifts his hand. Great God, he will not strike her. He's a man, and men are around him. Cowards, cowards, look, have ye no hearts?
He rolls to the ground, as if exhausted with passion. Ethelind bends over him.
He has fulfilled his work. Now for our own. See, I've the means and power to summon guests or little like to find a welcome here. Vivian, by this man slain, at base advantage, left these scrolls which shew of treasons working against the men he served. Tis but to warn them I would brave the night, were to like his own heart fierce and terrible on such a mission bound.
Brave, faithful girl! Would that my tidings could make light the way rather than cloud it. Comfort is no more, save in avenging. Latimer is dead.
Alas, and is it so?
2 days and nights I've wandered here, unconscious of the storms that howled above, bearing a mightier cloud, unwilling to let fall its fiery load upon a land already tempest-torn. She shall know all at once. The griefs that crowd together on the heart, like waves opposed, destroy each other. I will seek her. Thou bring her avengers. Ethelind, farewell.
Be tender in thy speech.
Need I such warning?
Exeunt severally. End of Act 4.
This audiobook is brought to you by Full Audiobooks. Please like, subscribe, and click the bell icon if you love audiobooks.
Act 5 of The Lords of Ellingham by Henry Spicer. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Act 5, Scene 1, An Apartment. Edith, in splendid apparel, seated on a couch, her head bent down on her hands. Gargantua kneels at her feet.
She hears me not, yet for a weary hour, slow as the wasting of age-long life, prolonged in torture, have I kneeled and prayed some word or sign of consciousness. Oh, speak, lady, sweet mistress, nay, she hears me not, my words have killed her.
Had they but such power, life that deserts joy's new and glittering fane clings to its dismal ruins. 'Tis the rich in hope who die, the loved, those for whose wealth bowed hearts and hands uplift and sacrifice of tears are offered. Vainly, I have made yet mightier sacrifice, and now to think, oh God, how great a woe!
Resumes her attitude.
Sweet madam, comfort.
Thou sayest that he is dead, that I have paid too late a costly price in desperate hope to gaze but once upon his ransomed brow and die for my reward. No more, no more. I pray thee rend away the screen of blood that crimsons all I look on. Thanks, kind heaven. I have not yet forgot the joy of tears. I shall not yet be mad. Now what remains? Seest thou no more to do?
When life's dull load hath grown too mighty for the bounded strength of fleshly hearts, how easy 'tis to cast the burden from us.
Come here, Gargantua. Thou wilt not leave me in these fearful toils. I know that thou hast loved me.
I have lived, and have no greater witness of my love for thee. For thee alone, Gargantua, the jest and scorn of men, has learned to curb a spirit lofty as their own, and borne life's curse thus long. Dost wonder at my word? Lady, I love thee. On this earth, which gave these forms so different birth, I kneel and say, lady, I love thee. With a love so deep, it scorns to wear the prostituted name that men bestow on it. It has not tears, that so its venom might be wept away. nor quenchless hoping, nor complaining word, to make its torture less, nor aught save calm, resolved, and stern endurance. Was it meet that this wild heart should lift its thought to thee in maddest dreams? No, to the welcome grave, its fittest home, had gone my tale untold. But that the terrors of these fateful hours had burst the cankered chain and rudely snatched the monstrous captive forth.
Hast thou too borne thy portion in the sorrow I have caused by being Edith? For such sake as mine, no heart shall suffer more.
Grant then my prayer, to serve thee but a little space, and then revenge.
And thou wilt serve me with true faith? Enough. I know thee. Thou wert wont to wear something within thy girdle. 'Twas my gift. Thou shalt restore it.
'Twas forced from me by one upon whose coward heart I sought to prove its temper.
Thou? What insult foul could rouse thee to a deed of blood?
Enough. He named thee slightingly.
It matters. Resolve is fruitful. There are means less swift, but not less certain. Nature is too kind in her great love to leave us medicineless for bosoms ill at ease. Hence, like a ghost, bring me fresh flowers, Gargantua.
Canst thou find solace in them? It is no wisdom, lady, to seek in gaudy and rejoicing things balm for sick thoughts.
What? Is thy wit so dull? Not those gay minions of the hour shall hold their court again with me. A different wreath befits me now. Well, I believe there is nor herb nor flower, how dark soever, or mean, or noxious to the taste, or touch, or smell, but for the soul's disease or corporal ill, hath some appointed ministry. Of such I speak, Sir Page.
Yet, madam...
Art thou one who needs a spelled and syllabled command? Ere wilt about it? To the garden, sir. Call me white lilies and the hooded flower that in its monkish cowl at once doth bear both death and healing. Nightshade, with its fruit of royal purple, drooping widow's flower, to me most fitting. Swallow wort of gold that lures the honey-seeker to his heart, then hugs the thief to death. And last, good page, forget not that stout hemlock, by whose aid the wise and honoured heathen won his way into the god's embrace. From these, fresh drawn from the pale night-dew's curtain, I will wring a draught of magic power.
Exit Gargantua. Edith remains in the same position until he returns with herbs, etc.
Thanks. Let me look on my deliverers. Cool and fresh and filled with that rich solvent, at whose softest kiss life's chain drops from us. For this service, boy, I make you free. Be happy.
I have gained, as yet, but half my prayer. The rest I claim, revenge upon the doer of this ill, and then I follow.
Stay, my soul hath fled beyond such thought. All hate, disgust, and fear, all thirst for vengeance, and all sense of wrong are dead within me. I'll not have it so. The ills that I have suffered are too great for man's revenge. I would not he should die. I'll tread that path alone. My last true friend, farewell!
Thy hand, sweet mistress. Oh, farewell.
Aside, turning away.
Now death, sole rival to whose arms I yield this royal prize, I pray thee linger not upon the beauty of thy sacrifice, lest I me repent, and in jealousy snatch it untasted.
He retires.
So, the hour is come. With what alacrity our quick desires stretch to that goal toward which, when far remote, they point but coldly. I am sickly chill. Oh God, how fearful is the solitude of a deserted heart.
Pause. She takes the flowers.
Poor drooping friends, of that false word where fairest smile and word the deepest hatred hide, fit emblems ye, so fair without, so full of death within. Thus I press the venom from your hearts. Oh, could mine own thus render up its poison and its life, and thus be nothing? Get ye from mine eyes, you blinding tresses, writhing adders, hence! Ye coil too closely toward the heart which holds alone its purity.
Starts wildly from her seat and kneels before a portrait.
Mother, 'tis thou shouldst stead me in this misery, but oh, it breaks my heart to look upon thy face so proudly innocent. Down, guilty head, into the dust of the impassive earth, that can no more thy dainty looks defile more pure than thou. My unknown parent, if, as I did, never nestle in thy breast, nor in thy kind arms ready refuge weep my infant griefs away, so my lost soul may miss the path to that blessed world where thou hast rest for aye. O mother sweet, look down, yet bless me once, my mother. Pray for her who, sick with sorrow and beset with snares, found this world's paths too rugged for her tread, and the grave's peace too tempting. Ah, what light steals o'er thy features! 'Tis heaven speaks to me in pardon of this deed, and lo, I hear a soft and gentle voice cry, Edith, come! Now!
As she is about to drink, the lattice is forced, and Dudley Latimer leaps down. A long pause.
Thy message from the dead!
I live, my Edith. Wife!
Edith, waving him off.
I know thee not! Away! The villain mocked me, for he could not save, and so my sweet lord died.
He lives for thee. Oh, if I dream not still, if thou'rt indeed my own blessed Edith, calm this frenzied mood. Oh, lost too long, come to thy home, my heart, and be at peace. I prepared a bower, secure and sweet. No envious hand can trace the spot where Dudley, with a miser's care, shall hide his treasure. Let the world sweep on to its own ends. We care not. Fortune may return, but we'll not stoop to woo her back, who bear within us an exhaustless mind that beggars her high state. Come, love, thy hand. Nay, dost not know me?
Aye, methinks I do. But do not jest with me, for I have slept, and had a dream so fearful that I see its phantoms round me yet. Oh, can it be that I should stand unchidden at thy side? No proud o'erweening virtue to stalk by and brand me with its silent look? No pang to rouse pale conscience from its sleep of death? But what is present shall be peace and love, and what is past oblivion? Didst thou say it should be thus?
Thus, even thus.
Edith, clinging frantically to him.
Oh, come! Why linger we? Why draw one other breath in this hot atmosphere of shame and sin? Oh, come, come, come!
It is my prayer.
Hold, hark! Did you not hear a whisper? I would fly, indeed I would, but even when I move, some unseen monster seems to coil around and bar my progress. Go, beloved. Farewell. Strive not with fate.
Latimer draws her toward the window and points.
See, we are safe already. There lies our path, our own sweet place of play in childhood's hours. And lo, the favouring night from her fringed mantle flings a silvery star to be our guide and welcome.
Gargantua stands before them.
Hold!
How now, creature of evil omen? Wherefore here?
To question thee, what wouldst thou do with a woman on thy arm?
With this true steel I would reply to thee, but thy wild tone and frantic fury gleaming from thine eyes make me believe all thought, save malice, now hath flown its hideous dwelling. From our path I would not crush thee.
Thou canst harm me not. Thou canst but gnash thy teeth, or weep, or rail, or leave on that misshapen lump of flesh ye call Gargantua a proof how well the murderer's knife is fitted to man's hand. "'Tis I am armed, not thou."
"The truth! On! On!"
"Those costly robes, whose glitter seems to mock their wretched wearer, shall help out my tale. Is it in such fair guise a woman mourns her murdered lord, or for his perilled life pours out her heart in prayer? When thou cam'st in, what panting welcome gave her lips to thee? Why sought she not in thine expecting arms her wonted shelter? Wherefore droops she now before thy glance, as if in dread that thou, in the pale volume of her look, shouldst read thy fate too quickly? Answer, what canst deem from these so slight but fearful witnesses, but that the garden keeper of thy store hath, like a traitor, burst the seal and made the prize his own?
Latimer, after a pause.
Fiend! Thou hast reached my heart, but malice fiery darts from love's strong shield fall quenched and harmless. Go, to thee I turn, love's earliest blessing, my sweet playfellow, my loved companion and of later days true friend and counsel. It was thine hand, the fond assurance thy love and faith bore up my fetters that I felt them not, nor knew they bound me. My lone draught grew sweet as with thy kiss. My dungeon seemed not drear. From every barred pane thy bright face shone, radiant with hopeful love. The accuser spoke his words of blood, the judge. I heard them not. There was no voice but thine, and thou, that thou shouldst play me false at last? Look up, my Edith, look proudly up. Let honour's princely mien, that needs no language, tell this crooked fiend he lies to God and thee. I charge you, speak a word, but one. Foul slanderer, prepare.
She has not spoken.
Proud, repellent scorn has chained her utterance. Edith, my beloved, spoke I too harshly? Look, I kneel with a suitor's humblest accent. I, with tears, adjure thee. From this rack of fiery pain, absolve me quickly. Ha! Thou'rt changing. What? Look up. How is't, my love? Gargantua, this is thy falsehood's work. Die, villain, die!
Seizes him violently.
She lives. She has not spoken.
Edith, to Latimer.
Loose thy hand. Thou task the accuser for the culprit. Dudley, let me not rack thine ear with words whose truth hath reached thine heart already.
Latimer, dropping his dagger.
I have heard of strange delusions that do mock men's souls. How changed thou art. Thy voice is deep and stern, that made such music as a sleepless bird might scatter through night's waste. That drooping form, where is its matchless majesty? Why grows thy brow so dark and wrinkled, which but now fair as an angel seemed?
Upon the shrine where I did offer up a fairer gift, my fatal beauty perished. There but needs one other sacrifice, one only. Poor and worthless and degraded is it, and shall quickly follow. Hadst thou, Dudley, come one moment later, all were done, and I had bought my pardon. I can bear no more the torment of thine eye. If thou hast pity, I pray thee, leave or slay me.
No, it is false. I ne'er yet doubted thee, but reason now rejects this wild confession. I will die in disbelief. I know thou'rt still my pure and honoured wife.
What darker doom hath heaven for guilt than here to force its gaze on its own deeds? My soul is pure, my love thine own, a diamond in the dust concealed of ruined virtue. I was sore beset, and hope's last dart flung with too wild an aim on my own breast recoiled. But penitence hath in the stern respect of virtuous men a strengthening power, and I will die, for then I feel death holy.
Live, then wash away the crime that with the dust of earth defiles what seemed too heavenly. Pray in angels' tears, if God's bright children mourn, shall yet blot out the guilty record. I have done with life. that naught has left me but to weep and pray that we may meet before his awful throne, there pure and pardoned, on each other gaze, knowing ourselves once more.
For that I thank thee, but I have a jealous oracle which gives a somewhat prouder counsel. There are sins by sinners judged, and in this world condemned, for which the motive may not plead in vain at the last judgment day. I could say more, but my polluted presence clouds thine eye, and makes thy cheek so corpse-like in its hue. Good night, sir, fairly, thou neglectful page. Why stand'st thou dreaming there, and givest me not my wonted draught?
Gargantua gives the cup.
Hold, sir, what hast thou there? What's in the cup?
That which gives healthier sleep than virtue can.
Latimer springs forward and snatches it.
'Tis poison? Hold thy hand.
Gargantua, taking up the dagger.
Low as thou liest, neglected peace-giver, many have found thy worth.
Edith, aside to Gargantua.
True friend, I thank thee. Quit not my side.
To Latimer.
My sometime lord, farewell. When we are parted, hear you Edith's tale. Then judge how far a woman's heart may bear, and where no longer. Live for happiness, but not, oh, not to envy me the doom, more welcome now than lapse of earthly years, unspecked with sorrow. Live to pardon me.
She snatches the dagger from Gargantua and stabs herself.
And to commend this deed.
I stand and gaze as if some magic touch froze me to stone, leaving no sense but vision, and that spared for torture, not in mercy. Art thou Edith, my love and life? My flesh begins to creep. How came I hither? Would this dream were o'er.
Dudley, come nearer. Speak, oh, speak again. I cannot. Nearer. All is darkness now. Say, did the angel that from deathbed strife sets free the panting spirit take thy tone? Or didst thou speak and call lost Edith thine?
My dear, speak for me. Edith, God. Oh, for some purpose from our thoughts concealed, hath suffered this great woe and mercy guide unto this victim's death-dull ear such balm as my weak words may give? Oh, love, believe that I did never in its purest day so feel thyself's nobility as now, or thus again I call thee, pressing this cold lip to lip, and bleeding heart to heart. My own. My own.
Oh, now most welcome rest. The day has been too long. Thou dost not know how I have prayed for death. Let me but lay my head upon thy bosom thus. Sleep.
The scene closes. Scene 2. The study. Night. Lorenzi at a table covered with books, papers, plans, etc.
Thrice have I moved those hangings, yet could swear that their dark folds concealed some form instinct with moving life. How yon grim portrait stares! His eyes outgleam my cresset. Sadeath, he smiles. Truce with thy ghastly merriment. I'll spoil thy grinning friend tomorrow. The night's revel hath somewhat wearied me, and sense o'ertaxed plays us, in spite strange tricks.
A pause, he writes.
'Tis very still, and yet it is not. I have seen writ that on the brooding earth no silence dwells, but ever there are mysterious sounds, whose source we know not, flitting to and fro, like shades condemned, that wander earth and heaven, yet nowhere find a home. Well, to these lists, hangings for chamber in the eastern wing, 6 nobles and a mark, for closing in the right of pasturage,
10 marks. The sale of old Dame Gillian's tapestry brought no more than 14 crowns. 14! Now, by my faith, why, here is roguery. So, master steward, thou shalt account of this thy stewardship. Wouldst fatten on my substance? Thou shalt hence, with thy glib tongue, and prate of thine old lord, as is thy wont to dotards like thyself. Thou'lt plunder not the new. What's this? The plan for building of the church you promised, when the steeple of the old one kindly fell and oped my landward view. They cannot pray, no roof above. No roof? The less remains betwixt their prayers and heaven. Away with that. I will not give a mark. Hark, someone stirs. 'Tis not. Lo, how the tongueless night doth give significance to every sound. Now I'll to bed. Tomorrow I'll...
A noise without.
Ha, there! Who comes?
Enter Dudley Latimer.
Stand, speak! What dark intruder's this?
Thy conscience, cousin.
God of heaven! I dream!
Call on the devil, man, thy friend of old. I am but his ambassador, and come to bid thee to the feast prepared for thee, his most trustworthy minister. Not ready?
Hold! From whence comest thou, Dudley?
Canst thou ask? Why, from King James's fair menagerie nursed in the Tower. His Grace has gathered there a choice collection. Noble beasts, if faith. A toothless lion, some 5 flamish bears, and divers monkeys from the realm of France, all mischievous as men. And who dost think was king among them? Raleigh, the witch Raleigh. Enough of that. A sorry welcome this to my fair home. The jealous doors all close, through an ill-fastened casement I was fain to grope my way, like some poor honest knave enamoured of his richer brother's hoard.
Dudley, be calm. What would you?
Oh, not much, most hospitable lord of Ellingham. No ceremony, sir. Sit down, I pray, and list a merry tale. I had a father. Why dost thou start? Is then so marvellous to have a father?
Stay, my friend. Some wine. Those varlets sleep. I dress.
Ha! Wet, I see. No matter. 'Tis not blood. Sit down, I say. Sit. Stir not, or I'll kill thee.
Lorenzi, aside.
Curses light upon those drowsy villains. I must take decisive measures. 'Tis mere charity to quell a madman.
Aloud.
Sit? Aye. Sit we down. Right welcome, cousin. Come.
Brings wine and cups.
A full carouse. Nay, take the larger cup. The draught is nothing. This is a merry meeting.
And shall be yet merrier ere it end. Aye, give me wine, for yon grim jailer played the niggard host. And truth to say, cold cells and prison fare do suck the marrow from quick-blooded youth and make a ghost of him.
Drinks.
There's life in that. How glibly through the warming veins the red magician speeds. He quickens words, breathes of the heart's dull eye, sets fire to thought, spurs up the lagging pace of memory, knits every joint anew. Now tell me, cousin, hast thou done well by me? Hast safely kept the gem I gave? Holds honour in thy breast her wonted throne?
Another cup, my friend. What catechism is this? Some foe of mine, for all on whom one smile of fortune beams, have foes to spare, hath soiled my fair report in my good kinsman's mind.
didst thou but know, though it becomes not me to speak of it, with what a reckless and unwearied zeal I sought thy pardon from the hands of those who thirsted for thy life. And Edith, too, thy gentle bride, with what a brother's love, respectful tenderness, and...
So I thought. Why, how the slaves belied thee. Good sir, since I walked this curious world, my fate has been to herd with strange companions. Some were bold, some stealthy sinners, murderers, courtiers, rogues, flatterers, and thieves. But never one so base, but in some secret corner of his heart, there lurked a chord of mercy. It might be a child, a dog, a bird, that kept the tone awake. But still 'twas something. Could I think thou wouldst not listen to that siren voice that older villains hear?
What dost thou mean? Mercy? To whom?
To that poor lamb, which I, deluded fool, hid in the he-wolf's den for safety. Hark, dost hear her bleating cry? Thou didst not think the shepherd's ear was yet awake to such a sound? I come. Thou shalt have succour soon.
Lorenzi, alarmed at his increasing violence, snatches a sword, which Latimer wrests from him and holds him in his grasp.
Take off thy hand. She shall come hither.
Can thy malice then outstride the grave? Wouldst make a slave of death? Break up the sacred palace of the tomb and hail thy victim hither by the shroud? Hark, in thine ear. She's dead. What? Is't remorse? Or fear? Or unbelief that makes thee blench and mutter to thyself? Now follow me, and mark if thou dost seek with voice or sign or footfall louder than thy wont to raise thy slumbering vassals to oppose my way, I'll strike thee to the heart. Dost hear me? Come.
Exeunt. Scene 3. A long gallery, dimly lighted. Enter Latimer and Lorenzi. Latimer stops before a picture.
That face is noble. 'Tis 200 years since on the battlefield that warrior hand built the first fortunes of an ancient house. 9 generations gone. No speck, ere yet stained his white honor's shield. Doubtless he thought that tree he fostered with his gallant blood would spread and flourish, and with lapse of years grow mightier. 'Tis cut down. A noble face?
'Tis noble. Ha!
Aside.
How slow thou dost thy part, my potent minister, when most I need dispatch. His cheek grows white. He gnaws his lip. Good, good. 'Tis working now.
Time presses. On.
They pass out at the other side. Enter Groesveld, half-dressed, armed with a huge sword.
May I never greet my native Holland, nor thy broad sweet face, my Anchen, if but now I heard not footsteps in this gallery. And lo, there's naught. The lamps burn dim and blue. I like not this dead hush. What? Wilhelm! Wilhelm!
Enter Wilhelm.
What hast thou found?
A vacancy! A void! Where I did look to find humanity. Wilhelm, I have been troubled much of late, with uncouth noises. Heavy footsteps tread above my chamber, where a pygmy scarce could squeeze betwixt the rafters. Nay, sometimes mine ears are startled with a dull, deep growl no human tongue might form.
Alas, I know too well that sound.
Groesveld, eagerly.
What is it? What is it, dear Wilhelm?
Dame Marjorie snoring.
Tut! Good Wilhelm, choose a better season for thy jokes than now, when it may be, behind yon very screen, a true live ghost sits listening to our talk, and fit to pounce on us. Hark! I'll be sworn I hear a horse tramp in the avenue. 'Tis plainer. Hark!
Both listen.
Why? Now I hear it too. Shall we not to the master?
That's my place. Speed to the door, and see thou question well these midnight riders ere thou. Hark, they come.
Exeunt severally. Scene 4. The apartment of Edith, as before. The corpse of Edith laid upon the couch. Latimer, Lorenzi, Gargantua.
The raven muttered as we passed along a note of death. The sullen clock hath told its midnight warning. Hast thou so much grace? Commend thy soul to God.
What mean'st thou?
Of the crown and limit of thy fell career is where thou stand'st. Each living breath of thine offers foul insult to that thing of clay. Thou hard of heart, I'll talk no more with thee. Look once again upon thy hellish work, then take thy meed.
Is't so? Then list to me with all the serpent passion of man's soul. I hate thee, Latimer, from childhood's days. From infancy, I hate thee. Thou hast been the shadow in my path, the cloud of my sky, the hidden reptile on whose slimy scales I trod and slipped, even from that boyish time when, sporting in the woods, I plucked a rose, the queen flower of the field, for Edith's hair, and you, the stronger, took the coveted prize away, and bade me seek if all the woods held such another. From that hour thou hast forestalled me ever. Who was taught me to sin? Who taught me jealousy? Whose influence drove my tortured heart to wild and reckless ways that rooted me from out thy father's love and set my bark afloat in life's wide sea with scarce a sail? Who took my promised bride, my beautiful, whose fair possessions might have given the outcast beggar wealth and home? 'Twas thou. And thou! And didst thou dream that I should cower and crouch beneath thy heel and speak thee fair, and with slavish whine bid scourge or slay me as thy mercy will? This is my answer!
Rushes on Latimer, a fierce struggle. Alarm without.
Help! Without there! Ho! A madman here o'erpowers me! Help! Oh, help!
One moment, good Gargantua. Go out the door, even with thy life, thy life.
The struggle continues. Gargantua secures the door.
Quick, quick! I faint! If ye be men, 'tis but a weakling child that keeps the door.
The door is burst in, and enter an officer with guards, who part them.
Behold your prisoner! Are you better strong? You'll need them all. Weak his looks and pale, the madness of his rage gives giant strength to his fierce struggles. Bind him. Well, he knows the taste of fetters.
Villain, 'tis for thee we bring these chains. Thou hast played false with those who bought thy service and must answer now those crimes for which thy ready treachery obtained conditioned pardon. In that land upon whose fostering soil thy guilt has left a bloody record, there are lips that burn to witness against thy crimes. 3 days from hence thou shalt embark for Holland to reply to the dark charges brought against thee there, and if condemned as guilty, to endure such penal tortures as our English law dare not inflict. Away with him!
My curse! My bitter curse! Light on ye! Hold! How now? What ails my gentle kinsman? Was the wine spiced to his palate? Come, wilt thou sup with me, dear cousin, or with her?
Points to the couch, and is led out guarded.
Sir, the dwarf page of whom the woman spoke to us lies dead beside the couch.
There is foam upon his lips, his features are distorted. He has drunk some fatal potion.
Let me have thine arm, Sir Soldier. I am full of deadly pains. Scorching thirst feeds on me. Streams of fire shoot from mine eyes, then leave them dark as night. My spirit that throughout a fearful hour has fought with death now yields. My martyred love, for my sake murdered, lead me to her side. Quick, I am dying. Dying. I know this face. How cold.
Falls on a couch. The end. End of Act 5. End of The Lords of Ellingham by Henry Spicer.
This audiobook is brought to you by Full Audiobooks. Please like, subscribe, and click the bell icon if you love audiobooks.